Hallelujah. Feel the sound of my voice with your presence, Lord. Feel the sound of our voice with your glory now. Feel the sound of our voice with your presence, Lord. Feel the sound of our voice with celebration. Us feel the sound of our voice with your glory, with your glory now. Feel the sound of our voice with your rivers. Feel the sound of our voice with your glory now. Oh, feel the sound of our voice with your presence. Oh, feel the sound of our voice with your authority. Oh, feel the sound of our voice with heaven. Lord, feel the sound of our voice with authority. Oh, feel the sound of our voice with heaven. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Feel the sound of our voice, glory, with your glory. Lord, feel the sound of our voice with your presence. Lord, feel the sound of our voice with your glory. Lord, feel the sound of our voice with heaven. Lord, feel the sound of our voice with your authority. Lord, feel the sound of our voice with heaven. Let's do that one more. Lord, feel the sound of our voice with your glory, with your glory. Lord, feel the sound of our voice with your presence, with your presence. Lord, feel the sound of our voice with your authority, with your authority. Lord, feel the sound of our voice with heaven. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you for your wonderful works. Come on, shout for a while of all the things that God is to you, all that he has done for you. He is the Almighty. He is El Shaddai. He is the Most High. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the Redeemer. He is the first and the last. He is the Savior. He is the Healer. He is the Holy Ghost Baptizer. He is the beginning and the end. He is the great I Am. He is the everlasting God. He's the one who laid the foundations of the earth and stretched out the heavens like a curtain. Come on, praise him for a while. Come on, praise him. Come lift your voice and shout. Come lift your voice in thanksgiving. Hallelujah. Satay also. Come lift your voice. Akis de Bravo. Sus to the Arabos. Sutrivia Sabraveo. Hallelujah. Come lift your voice. Come lift your voice. In praise unto the King. Come worship the Lord, the Most High, the Creator of the heavens and the earth. Woohoo! Come worship him. Bless the Lord, my soul. All that is within me. Hallelujah. Ah, mamma che testi prepari. Anna mandare se pretesti. Mande che anna mandare resti di marama orebe itarro ma oresti tarro boho. Irrevanta boho fissa. The young men will fail and faint, but those who allow the Spirit of the Lord God to fill them and strengthen them, where even the young men weary and fall to the side because they count upon their own strength, and though it be great strength, yet they'll still stumble, they'll still fall, they'll still faint. But they that wait upon the Lord, those who learn how to receive from the Holy Ghost, those who will be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord, they will rise up with wings as an eagle. They shall run and they will not faint. They shall run and not weary. They shall walk and not faint. There will be a high praise of God sounding out from you continually. There won't be the yell from hell. There will be a shout to the Lord. I said there won't be a yell from hell. There will be a shout. The argument, the fuss, the fight. It will be over. The shout, the praise, the glory realm of an extraordinary life will begin. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, Habakkuk, some of you are starting to get warmed up now. Some of you are starting to get up. Why quit now? We're just getting started. Turn the clock back 45 minutes. Oh, blessy Rebecca. Lord, we praise you. Lord, let your praise fill the earth. Let everything that has breath praise you. Oh, sun and moon and stars. Oh, clouds. All these things that belong to creation. Praise him. Let all of his saints praise him. Hallelujah. Delight yourself in the Most High. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we praise you. Lord Jesus, we bless and praise your holy name. Be with you. Listen, people of God, many times all that stands between you and a great outbreak of the Spirit of the living God through you is just a wall that's trying to hinder your praise and worship. If you grab a hold of the strength that the Lord supplies and you begin to lift up your voice with that wellspring that God has given because He desires us to worship Him by the Holy Ghost, and something that's true and deep that fuels our emotions and our passion and a longing for God, a hunger that only He can satisfy, a thirst that only He can fill, a hunger that only He can feel, a thirst that only He can satisfy. No. I promise you, a flow to every dimension of your life, whether it's financial need, physical need, the spiritual outworking of growth and maturity, which is something that is the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is in serious need of right now. Maturity in the things of the Spirit. Amen. I tell you, I love to see God's people face shining with the presence of the Lord. You can't praise over top of problems. But you can take the blood of Jesus, you get scrubbed up. And you can come to a place in the Holy Ghost of repentance to where you're never going to go back to that sin and iniquity and that evil. Because for many people, that's the blockade that Satan is effectively able to run against them. And the beauty of what Father has given to us through the new birth. You can be seated, because I want to talk to you a little bit about really the scale of joy that Father expects, the scale of joy that He supplied, the scale of joy that represents heaven. You have to understand that the new birth, when we received the new birth, when we became new creatures, we became a new creation, we went from being human beings to being divine beings. Look, God made, He gave us the divine nature. We became one with Him. We became the house of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. I mean, what else can you describe this to be? To leave it just as the ordinary, casual, everyday, run-of-the-mill person born of the flesh is just absolutely wrong. That which is born of the flesh, or that which is born as a human being, is a human being. This is the introduction to the gospel. I know it's strange to many people simply because they just don't listen close enough. That which is born of God the Holy Ghost belongs to God the Holy Ghost. And Jesus said that which is born of the Spirit, or God, that which is born of the Holy Ghost is Holy Ghost. Amen. He said that which is born of the Spirit is Spirit. Amen. He was very definite. It's pretty radical. Yeah. Look, come on, people. We're just trying to help you understand that you can't continually act like men and have the blessings and the products of all that God has blessed us with that takes an agreement with the Word of God and a growth and a maturity in faith, because you're exercised in those things. You give yourself to these things. You know, when you're born again, you know, Jesus described it when He's talking to the woman at the well. Hallelujah. I feel the presence of God. He's wonderful. Hallelujah. Moving into... Because reality of it is I want to just stay where we were at, you know, that we finally got to, beginning to get to scratch the surface. Because if you stay there, ultimately what will come out of that is what God wants in His church when He said the manifestation of the Holy Spirit is given to every man, where everyone is now empowered by the Spirit of the Lord to prophesy, to speak in tongues, interpretation of tongues. But we're putting on a show. Church has become a show. It's become performance oriented. In reality, so much of it is about merchandising God's people. And folks don't like to hear me talk about this. And so when I try to do it from a pastoral point of view, the church doesn't get very big. But, you know, people want me to come to different places, to their house, to really straighten things out. But bottom line of it is nothing's going to get straightened out until somebody, some group of people somewhere says, no, I'm not interested in just singing a song. I want to sing by the Holy Ghost, yes, with the Spirit, yes, and with the understanding. Yes. I'm not just interested in a praise service. I want something that is supernatural, it's superior, yes, to the natural. Yes. It's something, yes, that only God the Holy Ghost produces. Yes. And it looks like a river of divine expression. It's divine expression. It's not a river of our expression. It's a river of the expression of the very person of Almighty God called the Holy Spirit. And it was within that, it is within that context that I want to talk to you about this tonight, because there's so much all the way back to Leviticus that builds on this subject, that ultimately Jesus cries out with a loud voice and He says, if anybody's thirsty, come to Me, and out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. This spake He of the Holy Ghost. And I'm going to tell you right now, tonight you want to have a hunger that only God can feel and a thirst that only God can satisfy. And if you get real with Him, and you're not willing to let it be any other way. Amen. It's like Peter basically threatened by the storm and the waves, but here he sees Jesus walking towards him in this realm of divine power that none of them even, I mean, even though they just fed more than 20,000 people with a few loaves and a small fishes, yet now they see the Lord in the heavenly realm, that Peter's going, I got to be there too. I want to be there too. Bid me come to you. I want to be that in that realm too. And so when we gaze upon the Word of God, it's supposed to activate something in our lives. I want that. And then we can't have this, I want this, with this kind of doubt and complaint. And I don't think, I want it, but I doubt God's going to give it to me. I want it, but something, you know, is in my way. It doesn't seem like I can have it. It's got to be a faith and a confidence that I say, I receive it now. Somebody said, I want them to flow and function in tongues and interpretation in tongues. I said, go right ahead. Do it right now. Because folks are acting like there's some kind of third, fourth, fifth, sixth work of grace that's got to take place for them to have it. People talk about, you know, the Methodists and them Nazarenes, they got two works of grace, you know, salvation and sanctification. Well, how many works of grace do you have? And I mean, just step into the thing and have it now. This is the day of the Lord. This is the year of the Lord. It's time that we grow, that we just go ahead and grow in that which God has given us, and just because we function in it. Hallelujah.
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 Thank you, God, for your goodness. I'm on the I hope you're as drunk in the Holy Ghost as I am right now. I hope you're as caught away in heaven as I am. Sometimes I think, my goodness, am I the only person enjoying myself in the place? And, you know, I just feel like, you know, all of a sudden we just become a spectacle. We're on display. Everybody just watches us do it. It's time for the church of the Lord Jesus Christ to rise up in divine power and glory, begin to function in all these things concerning the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, discerning of spirits, the working of miracles, the gifts of healing, the gift of faith, prophecy, tongues, interpretation of tongues, signs and wonders, the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power that is going to find its beginning in you being able to break out of whatever you're into with praise and thanksgiving. People are locked into a prison because their body is sick and tired. And I can't blame it. But nonetheless, they're just locked into a prison of being sick and tired. And so they just can't get past the fact that they're tired and then they're sick and they can't bust through into praise. Other people just have it in various different spiritual dimensions. There's all these various different excuses. People, at some point in time, you're going to learn how the fact to realize, you're going to come to understand the truth that there's always the opportunity for you to have busting forth the presence of the living God and divine expressions through you. And you don't have to have a preacher talk to you for 50 years to finally get it. The woman at the well got it in one meeting. I mean, it was a short meeting too. Ask of me, recognize who I am, Jesus said. Recognize who I am. Recognize that I got a gift for you, even though you're an adulteress. You've been married 5 times and you're living man with a man who's not your husband. Come on.
Yes.
Huh, that really blows up a whole lot of people's theories on, you know, divorce and it's in, you know, inexcusable it is. It's wrong, but I'm going to tell you right now, God has got mercy and forgiveness.
Yeah. Amen.
Isn't he good? 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 He didn't try to come up with some big explanation, a wrong, drawn out plan, what they got to do to get right with God. Got to go through so many years of counseling and so many years of inner healing and deliverance ministry, and then, no, recognize who it is, and I'm the gift that God has for you, and there'll be a wellspring springing up on the inside of you, the very life of God. Eternal life is the life. Eternal life is a description of the life of God. It's the description. John, in his first epistle, made it the description of the life of Jesus, and he said that the eternal life was manifested unto us, and we have shown unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us, to quote it more accurately, 1 John 1:2. He personifies eternal life as being the very life of Jesus Christ. The new birth brings to us the life of Jesus. I mean, just think about that. Just think about that. That's just the wellspring. The new birth brings to us the life of Jesus. At that moment of time, you get a new heart. You get a new spirit. He writes his laws upon the tables of your heart and your mind so that you're a living epistle, so that people go, wow, you're a heavenly being. You're a heavenly person. You're from heaven. Oh, you belong to the realms of the supernatural, the realms of the Holy Ghost. Oh, you're a God person. Oh, you're a Jesus person. And it's as obvious as the light shines. It's as obvious as the difference between the sun and the moon.
Yes. Amen.
is as different as somebody standing alive by a casket and a person who's in the casket. It's the contrast of death and life, light and darkness. And people, it all begins in this place of praise and shout and worship. It's all, everything that's going on in heaven, when you look at heaven at any time, that's what's taking place. It's something pure, it's something holy. People try to shout and praise over top of sin and iniquity. You cannot. You take a hold of the blood of Jesus Christ, and through repentance and crying out to God for His mercy, you take that wonderful means by which the Lamb supplied for us a cleansing, so that we would be loosed from our sins, delivered from them, purified unto God by the blood of Jesus Christ. And it's washed away, it's removed. There's nothing standing between you and God. You don't have to be guilty. You don't have to be shamed. You don't have to have condemnation. Get rid of condemnation, and you're going to have signs and wonders and miracles in your life quickly. There is therefore now no condemnation of those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after human ability and not after the realms of the human frame. Do not walk as men. Because that's really the bottom line. You know, linguistically, that's what those verses of Scripture are telling us. That's what those Greek words mean. You don't walk after the framework of a human being, the flesh. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, has not changed from what Jesus said in John 3, 3 through 6, and what Paul is expressing in Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 9. It's no different. Same flesh. Human being. But you walk after the divine power, a grace, a gift. A gift. A gift. Look how quickly she got it. Look how quickly she got it. Yeah. And so quickly she turns into an evangelist. She runs back to her place and says, come, meet a man who told me everything that I ever did. Surely this is the Messiah. Yes. And now what is he talking about? He's talking about worship. He's talking about getting a heart right so that you can worship, so you can begin to adore Him, so you can begin to praise Him. So all the things that the Spirit of the Lord said about praise, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. All of the things that the Spirit of the Lord said about joy and rejoicing can begin to be a reality in you, that you don't have to kind of, you know, make it happen religiously. It's you don't have to drill a well, a borehole. Stick a pump in it and mechanically get it out. It's the wellspring springing. It's springing. It's springing. Springing. It's a bubble up. It is a bubble up. In the Hebrew language, the way that you expressed a spring bubbling, coming out, because if you've ever been around springs, I mean, I've got a spring that is out at a ranch, and you could just see it where you're looking at it. It doesn't look like much. It's just bubbling up. But if you go down a little ways, it's a stream. It's flowing 35 gallons per minute plus. There's other springs that we can go look at that I've actually seen and been a part of property that I've owned. And you just look at it just bubbling up. And you go down about, you know, 100, 200 yards from it. And it's a creek that's flowing 200 gallons a minute plus. I've seen some that have been up to 2,000-3,000 gallons. And when you go look at where it's coming out of the ground, it's just bubbling up. In the Hebrew language, it's called Nabo. It's Nabo. Huh? It's Nabo. It's Nabo. Nabo. And from Nabo comes Nabi. Nabo, there's this word Nabi. Nabi means to prophet. It's the prophet. It's the utterance of the prophet. It's a bubble up. And there's this thing that starts happening when you break free. I mean, I just like to say breakthrough. I hate to say break free because I hate thinking that God's people are constantly going in back into bondage every between meetings. I'd rather just say breakthrough. And things will try to affix itself and attach itself to you so that you don't have a nubble. You don't have a bubble up. You got to try to, oh, Lord, I don't feel nothing. I'm just going to go ahead and do something. And it sounds hollow because your love, the love and the affection and the emotion, the passions and the gratefulness and the thanksgiving. Huh? I pray in the name of Jesus tonight that you grab a hold of the reality that the Spirit of the Lord is here to give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation tonight. You don't have to wait. So tonight you can grab a hold of these things. So tonight you can have them. Tonight they become yours. Tonight that you, from this point on, you quit acting like people from Southern California, you start acting like people from heaven. You quit acting like people who have been taught of men and gone through all these grades in school. You start looking like people that are taught of the Holy Ghost and start jumping around and dancing. And there's people who take the dance and they allow it to be profane. The dance is sacred. The dance isn't to go, let some spirit of the world teach you how to flow in demon spirits while you do ballet. And give your children over to learning how to be Jezebels and to learning how to function with the mother of harlots. And people hate it when I say these things. And there's, you know, that's why the exit sign is lit up. And there's a lot of times people are looking for, where is that thing? Where's the door? Where's the exit? Because they don't want to believe this. They don't want to agree with God. They say, oh, that's your opinion. Oh, yeah. Oh, really? You know what? I don't want to be like you. I don't want the fruit of your life. I don't want what's going on in your life. I want to be like what God's described me in His Word. And I'm going to conform to the Word. I'm going to conform to the image of Christ Jesus. I'm going to do exactly what God's called us to do and consecrate our life and have no fellowship with the world and not be a part of those things that belong to a demon-inspired, demon-cursed world. God's calling us out. Because if you do, you're not going to be able to flow over here in this realm. People say, oh, don't tell me that we can't get drunk on alcohol. Of course, they don't say it that way. That we can't have a glass of wine. That's what they always say. They get drunk. We can't have a glass of wine or drink beer because after all, you know, Jesus, you know, he like made 600 gallons of wine at the marriage in Canaan. And so what are you saying to me? What we're telling you is, number one, it wasn't, Jesus didn't make a bunch of wine and get everybody wasted on alcohol. They're a drunk, slobbering, drunk mess. And you can see, if you never read my booklet on alcohol, I've got a chapter in there. It's called The Intoxicated Jesus. It just basically goes with this whole thing that Jesus made a bunch of alcoholic beverage for everybody to drink, and they all got toasted. Because if you're going to say it, then go all the way with it. Because if they're guzzling, everybody's guzzling. If Jesus made it, and if it was good enough for Jesus to make it and supply it to other people, then he's going to drink it too. And God said, cursed is any man who brings strong drink to his brother's lips. So Jesus was cursed. So we can continue on with the reasoning. We can continue on with the evaluation. But the reality of it is people getting wasted on alcohol. Everybody knows alcohol is destructive. Look at, there's enough history. There's enough data. There's enough people whose lives have been destroyed. Families have been broken. People end up in gutters over alcohol. We don't have to wonder what the fruit of alcohol is. It's stinking demonic. And people who drink alcohol and sip on the thing, I mean, they don't know how to flow in the Holy Ghost because their lives are conflicted. They're tasting of the world. They're being drunk on the things of the world. And it's just one example of it because there's many things that people compromise with, so they never step into the joys of an extraordinary life. What Jesus called an abundant life is the another way to say that is extraordinary life. I've been given an extraordinary life. I've been given a God kind of life. But the Lord doesn't leave it there. He doesn't leave it to where that we can just have this life of new creation epistles written of God, read of men, the very life of Jesus being revealed in us, the tabernacle temple of the Holy Spirit. He gives to us the ability now, he takes it to another level and gives us the ability not only to live the life of Jesus, but to function in his ministry, yes, in his power. And that's called the baptism in the Holy Ghost. So it says that the Holy Spirit comes to us with the ability to live the life through the new birth. And Father wants to talk back and doesn't want it to be separated from anyone because he's given every one of us the commission to go and be witnesses. And we can't be witnesses unless we're endued with power because we can't properly represent him unless we know how to open up blind eyes and cast out devils and raise the dead. And have you been practicing? That's where people get silent. When's the last time you went in the morgue and said, listen, prepare the body, I'm going to spend some time with it. I'm planning on walking out with the person. Make sure they're dressed properly. No, seriously. Oh, no. Then you got to be weird. You got to be some kind of freak, some kind of person that's real on the fringes or whatever. No. This is who we are. I'm going to promise you right now, you begin to lay hold on the things that God has purposed to do through your life, and you will have them. Amen. You will have them. The reality is we're conflicted. We've got one eye on the world and one eye on Jesus, and it looks and it's weird looking. Huh? We call it old crooked eye. It is weird. It is about time we get a single vision. Their eyes become straight, fixed upon him. The Lord will take you from being filled with the circumstances and the situation of a wind and wave that's contrary to you, something that's threatening your life, threatening your commission, to where all your whole senses are filled with heaven, where you hear him saying, come, walk on the water with me. Your hearing is filled with the glory of heaven, where your view and what you see is filled with the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you can have it now or you can have it never. And always just delaying it, always waiting. Someday, well, you know what, I know what it is, but you know, we're not going to have it tonight. We're going to have it next Wednesday. Next Sunday, tomorrow, the procrastination, the spiritual deception that always waits for another day when it's today, when it's right now, where you can lay hold, where you can grab a hold of what God has given. What's here right now? I've got it. So God's no respecter of person. I got to, well, you know, come on.
It's good.
What he's done for one, he'll do for you. Anything that has been done in the scripture is precedence that is God wants, that God the Father has purposed to do it through your life. Have it now.
Amen.
Don't tell me about your genealogy, because I'm not interested in your genealogy. Huh? And your vain babblings about how that your dad was somehow, you know, very stoic, and so you're stoic too. Well, my dad is God Almighty.
Amen.
And there's not one stoic thing about him. He's full of joy unspeakable.
Amen.
He's full of life and passion and glory. Hallelujah. True. Now, let me just kind of, before I get into what I want to tell you, let me help you understand. First and foremost, when you're reading the seven signs of the Gospel of John, which all of Jesus' ministry is built around those signs, because it's declarations of who he is, and he builds sermons around the miracles which he did, and especially the way that the Gospel of John is presented, of course, beginning with the water turned into wine. But by the time you get to John chapter 7, John chapter 7 and John chapter, all the way through John chapter 9 are connected. Really, John chapter 8 and John chapter 9 are supposed to be read together. But let me just help you understand the whole setting of this, the whole framework of this, because John chapter 7, 8, and 9 is all about things that happen around the Feast of Tabernacles. The Feast of Tabernacles ultimately became associated with Israel. In Israel, it became associated with Ezekiel chapter 47, that there a river would flow. There would be a river that would flow, a stream, a healing stream that would flow out of the temple of the living God. And so what they would do at the Feast of Tabernacles is they would go down to the Pool of Siloam. Say, the Pool of Siloam, where else have I heard about the Pool of Siloam? Oh, you heard about the Pool of Siloam in Isaiah chapter 8 and verse 4, when the Lord says, you rejected the healing waters, the gentle healing waters of Siloam, and you went after your strange god of Risa and Rephaim. Yeah, you can look that up. Oh, where else did I hear about the Pool of Siloam? Oh, when the Lord healed the blind man, because every that was born blind, because every human being that ever comes to this world is born blind. And without the initiative of Christ Jesus to come and touch us and come and minister to us his life and his mercy and his grace, we will continue in darkness eternally. He stepped into this world as the light of life so that those who sit in darkness might see light. All humanity sat in darkness and under the shadow of death, but great light has sprung up.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's in this context that we're looking at the Feast of Tabernacles, because Jesus is watching them. I mean, it was the most extraordinary, rejoicing time of joy, because the Lord has already set the precedence in Leviticus chapter 27. For 7 days, you're supposed to come and rejoice ecstatically before the Lord. And now you better get into it, because you don't got the Holy Ghost helping you. This is what you're commanded to do, and let's make it look good. And so they had classes all year on how to get really excited and dance around. On the eighth day of the feast, it was the most joyous day of it all. It's where they went and drew water from the Pool of Siloam. And that night, they would take four big torches that were in front of the temple, and they would light them up so that these torches would just light the city up like no other night light, especially the courtyard of the temple and the precincts of the temple. It would light it up like no other time. It was just this fierce, burning torch. Four of them, and they would dance the night away. All night they would dance and rejoice in joy and celebrate and be excited about this wonderful event of coming Messianic age, where the death and sickness and disease and the curse would be removed, and God Almighty would reign, and they would reign with him over all the nations of the earth. Well, they've been dancing. Jesus said, they go grab water. Jesus cries out, hey guys, because there's what they're doing is they're singing Isaiah chapter 12 verse 3. What are they singing? With joy shall we draw water from the wells of salvation. Somebody said, I don't know how to draw water. I don't know how to let this wellspring spring. Get with joy is how you let the wellspring spring. Yes. Nehemiah is devoted to this. Nehemiah talks about these events in Nehemiah chapter 9 and 10. And that's where you hear the joy of the Lord is your strength. The joy of the Lord shall be your strength in the day of adversity. Listen, whether you realize it or not, you live in every day in the day of adversity. You're supposed to live it in heaven, but you've got an adversary who wants to destroy you and overwhelm you with his lies and his deceit. And it's the joy of the Lord that will be your defense. Hallelujah. And if you don't have much for church, you don't have any out there. This is the time that you get a supernatural impact on whatever it is you've been yielding to. No, that's really not a hallelujah. For me, it's like, oh my goodness. This is what God's got to work with. I'm hearing you on the hallelujah part because, I mean, it's about time you start getting seated with a little bit of joy that goes beyond just a human smile. I'm going to be happy today. I'm going to look good. I'm going to have a good demeanor. I'm going to be kind to folks. To where, rather instead, you touch heaven, you have a supernatural encounter with God, and a bubble up takes over. A bubble up. You give yourself to prayer every, listen, you give yourself to a, consecrate yourself to a prayer, and it won't be long, and I don't care what you're doing, the bubble up will start right about that time. Because you've been doing it for years. The bubble up right there. You know, even when the clock change, even the clock change. Clock change, and it's not even time, but it is time. I can't help it. They set the clock back or they set it forward. It's time. And there's the, you can say, well, it's not 7 o'clock yet. You know, whatever. It's 6 o'clock or 8 o'clock, whatever the case may be. But the knob, the bubble up is right there. And you can't shut it off. It don't matter what you're doing. You might as well go ahead and get yourself sorted out. But it's so wonderful to be, learn how to so yield to God that you sweep away with it. Yeah. But if you're overcome and you're oppressed and you're tormented by the things that you're allowing in your life and you do not know how to be freed from them, then you're going to have to understand how to break through those hindering spirits. You're going to have to, the Lord wants to make you strong so you can, you know, leap over the troop and leap over the wall and run through the troop, you know. He wants to show you how that whatever is hindering you, whatever fortified thing is resisting you from living in your inheritance, a shout of praise could bring down the walls of it, you know. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Whatever prison it looks like you've been confined to and whatever wall you've been chained to, and even if it's the darkest hour and it's midnight, you begin to shout to God, then chains going to fall off, the earthquake's going to come, prison door's going to come wide open. The Lord says it over and over and over again to us. It's like all you need to do is just begin to appropriate this. Understand that Father is the one who organized, ordained, and seated this whole concept of the Feast of Tabernacles. And so Jesus is standing there on the day, the great day of great joy and celebration and rejoicing. And of course, Josephus says there was nothing like it on the face of the earth. Other people report there is nothing like it. The celebration was completely wild and crazy, full of ecstasy and every kind of emotion of joy that people could express. And anything that they could do to create that joy or to have that joy, they did it. And it was on the eighth day. And it was that point in time that Jesus said, hey, you guys really thirsty? You really want a drink? Come over here. I'll give you the water. You want to have some joy expression? I'll give you rivers out of your belly, out of your emotions and passions. That's what he said. Will flow rivers of living water. Somebody said, he said belly. Well, do you know what belly means? Are you talking, do you know the Greek word is kolia, which is, well, how are you going to translate that? Colon? Are we saying colon? What are you talking about? It literally is an application of emotions and passions in Attic Greek. So we understand what it was. He could have used many different words. And he chose those words. I don't know exactly the Hebrew word that Jesus said at that particular time. But when he ordained for it to be inscribed and written out in the Gospel of John, you could argue that Matthew is written in Hebrew and translated into Greek. But you cannot argue that for the Gospel of John. When he chose, because he is Christ Jesus in charge. He's not some little God's way off in the prison of heaven. He's absolutely sovereign almighty that is watching over everything that happens in the midst of his wonderful work of redemption. And when he chose for the word to be put there in the Greek language, he said, kolia. It's like John's writing, he's writing, and out of what, Lord? The heart, the spirit, the soul, the liver, what? The mind? What? The mouth? What should we put here? He says, Kolia. Kolia. Okay, got to go ahead and write that down. I don't know what that means. I'm going to write that down. Shall flow rivers of the Holy Ghost, rivers of living water. This spake he of the Holy Ghost because the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because he had not yet been glorified. Uh-huh. Now, yeah, they just ignored him. They just walked right on by. Oh, it's ridiculous. What's wrong with that guy? It's ridiculous. And they continue on with their celebration of joy, wanting to be involved in the great Feast of Tabernacles. Why, the Feast of Tabernacles was standing there. And they couldn't. They're going to do the religious thing rather than receive a supernatural encounter with heaven. They're too busy doing their rituals. They're too busy singing their songs on their overhead. Huh? They're too busy waiting for their favorite song that always stirs them to come up on the overhead so they can do whatever it is that they do. Or were they waiting for that, whatever religious thing that's going on? Because I like to take that thing and place it right where you're at. What's keeping you from flowing in what Father's freely given? What's keeping you from divine expressions? How long must we deal with human expressions? I want to see Jesus. God wants to see Jesus. Father demands the fruit of Jesus in our life. And you better get to cultivating right now.
Amen. Thank you, Holy Spirit.
You better get to cultivating right now. Father demands it. And the beautiful thing of it is this, it's what he's demanding, he also supplies, but he can't supply it outside of our will submitted to it.
Amen. Thank you.
Well, they danced the night away. They all burned out. Jesus is fresh. Because he wasn't over there doing all the jig. He went to sleep. They're doing they're doing, because it's the torches represented the light of the world, the light coming in the midst of darkness and shining in darkness, and there being no need for the sun because God being the light thereof. They're just doing this in a celebration fashion. Meanwhile, the light of the world is sleeping because they didn't want to come up for a drink. They just looked at him like he was some guy who's completely, nutcase. And they really brought him all the way to the point of being demonized. So the next day, Jesus seeing all these burned out people, that is your dialogue in John chapter 8. And Jesus is rough in John chapter 8. He's rough. He's rough. He lays it out. He said, you don't even deserve to be called the children of Abraham. Your father is the devil. I mean, read John chapter 8. I mean, Jesus is at a high all-time rough. I mean, he got rough in John chapter 6. After multiplying the few loaves and fishes, small fishes, and then everybody ran to meet him. And he's like, he wasn't tired. He wasn't being grumpy. He was being real. He says, you guys didn't come over here because you love interacting with heaven. You came over here because you kill it and you need some food for your belly. And that's what he said. That's what he said. You just came over here because you want to get fed. You're not interested in manna and spiritual food. This is what he said. He was saying, no, he didn't. Yes, he did. He did. Go back and read. Go back and read. And then to really sort him out, he said, I'm going to tell you right now. Eat my flesh and drink my blood. If you don't eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life in you. Now they're really upset. Well, how can he give us his flesh to eat and his blood to drink? Well, this brings us to, many disciples left him that day. They no longer went with him. They were right involved. They were involved in so many wonderful, glorious miracles. The feeding of the 20 plus thousand people was an amazing miracle. I mean, that was heaven came to earth that day on a scale that had never been seen like that before. I mean, Elijah took 20 loaves, set it before 100 men, and it was multiplied, and they were all filled, but nothing had ever been seen like this. This is the Word made flesh now creating something from nothing. And everybody's not only get a bite, they all filled to the full. They can't eat another thing. They can't have had some more fish than they've had all year, kind of thing. They're stuffed, and there's still 12 basketfuls of fragments left over. This is an extraordinary miracle that you didn't get done in an hour and a half. I can't believe it. Church is still going. It's 2 hours later, 3 hours later, 4 hours later. There's something seriously wrong with these people. They've been going for 4 hours, this church service. Now, these are church services that went days, because it took days to work the kinds of miracles that Jesus was working all day long. Huh? the realms of divine power and the realms of divine glory. You know, I like to think about, you know, I'm doing a booklet right now on the seven signs of the Gospel of John, and just helping people just understand a little bit more about some of the details that have been overlooked. But when you just look at, you know, the man who was laid there at the Pool of Bethesda, who was waiting for an angel to come and stir the waters. For 38 years he's been in this condition. But he exercises more faith in an angel that's going to come and stir the water than God's people do in the reality of Christ Jesus in the midst of his church with the resident gifts of healing and miracles that is here right now. Think about it. He's going to be a testimony to all the church. Wait a minute, guys. I laid around for 38 years waiting for the angel. And every time I'm just about to get my finger in the water where somebody else got in, they jumped in ahead of me. I had no man to help me. I was a pathetic situation. Jesus came and he delivered me. But the reality of it is look at his faith and his confidence. An angel who stirs the water. When in reality, I mean, once again, I come from a long line of revivalists. They understood that the meeting needed to run for 12 weeks, 8 to 12 weeks, sometimes as much as 6 months, because some people got their healing on the first day, but some people didn't get their healing until the last day. There was things to be broken through, and are they willing to go through the process? Are they willing to be in every meeting? Are they willing to press in past all of their weakness and past all their failure and past all their unbelief and past all the obstacles and press through the crowd of hindrance that's set before them? Because the Lord's going to try our hearts. We just want the Lord, you know, and Lord, you know, I'll take a fry and two shakes or whatever, you know, it's just, and make it quick because I've only got 30 seconds. You know, Lord God, I'm going to give you this chance to work a miracle for me. If you don't go through, I'm scheduled for a surgery in the morning. No, it's so sad. And now people are mad at me. Now I got to be persecuted for saying it. That's okay. Bring it, man. Go ahead, bring it. I don't even care. I had lost any value of care a long time ago. Bless me. Persecute me. Tell me that I'm wrong. The reality of it is, Jesus is our great physician. He's the healer. He supplied it to all, whosoever. It's the children's bread. A woman who was not willing to take no for an answer, who is of the tribe of Jezebel, a Phoenician, Christ Jesus is not even sent to her. He's not even sent to her and to her people, is able to lay hold on the children's bread for healing. Because she says, a crumb will do for me. She wouldn't take no for an answer. And she learned how to fall down and worship before the master. I'm calling you. And Jesus said, I'm calling this and telling you, this is great faith. This is what I'm looking for. He changes the order of the covenant to suit her. And you don't even have to have the order of the covenant changed for you to have the children's bread, which is healing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's your daily bread. You people say, "Oh Lord, give us our bread. Give us this day our daily bread." You didn't realize you were asking for healing in a New Testament, Old Testament, in a biblical context. You're asking for the healing that you need. God takes good care of us. I was reading this afternoon. I like to glance at the headlines of the news to see who blew up, see if anybody's blown anybody up yet. Not that I'm too concerned about it, but nonetheless. It's kind of intriguing. And there's this guy, you know, he strep throat went down in his stomach. They couldn't figure out what was wrong with him. They opened up his stomach. Stomach's full of mucus. He goes in with a stomach ache and leaves with no hands and no feet. Because sepsis set in, blood flow, you know, the same streptococcus that you get strep throat from went down into his belly. Barely able to keep him alive, and he loses his hands, he loses his feet. And I was sitting there thinking, Father, it just is amazing how kept I am by the power of God. Amen. Lord, how good you are to us. Amen. How you provide for us. How, Lord, you keep us from more sicknesses than we've ever even considered to think about. Lord, you kept us from more accidents and more fatalities. You preserved us. Lord, you've delivered us from every snare that Satan laid for our feet. We didn't even know it. And if we could just get a little bit of insight for a moment, we're going to become praisers, man. We're going to become those who are just giving, you know, thanksgiving to God. Let me spend a little bit more time thanking for him for all that he's done. Because I wouldn't even be here right now. I wouldn't be alive. I wouldn't have nothing. I'd be destitute. I'd be in hell for eternity. I mean, just if you just stop on the reality of what His blood has done for us and cleansed us, how our names have been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I mean, how can you stop praising just over that? That He's filled us with His presence, that He's given to us everything that pertains to life and godliness, that He's blessed us coming in and blessed us going out, that we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly places, that we don't have to spend an eternity in a place called the lake of fire. God was to number sin or count sin, there would nobody be, no one would be able to stand before Him. But in His goodness and His grace, He's removed our sins as far as the east is from the west to remember them no more. If I were to have to give an account for just one sin that I've done, I deserve an eternity in the lake of fire. People don't even got that revelation yet. They don't even understand that. Because they're so compromised with relativism and humanism and the culture that they don't realize that one act of sin is deserving an eternity of being cut off from God. And if you just begin to allow this reality of truth to work on the inside of you, you wouldn't be so flippant with your life. And furthermore, you begin to exalt Him and praise Him that He in His grace and His mercy has now looked at us and empowered us to be holy even as He is holy, to be righteous like He is righteous, to walk just like He has walked, not a threat but an empowerment. I want to I want you to look with me for just a few minutes at just kind of walk you through some verses of Scripture to try to help you understand what rejoicing is. I feel like I need to diagram it. Do special instructional videos on it. This is joy, this is not joy. This is rejoicing, this is not rejoicing. This is the sound of praise. This is the sound of complaining. See, this person looks happy. They could be rejoicing. See, this person looks sad. They're definitely not rejoicing. It's one of the first evidence that the Spirit of the Lord has rule over your life and that you're sealed with the Spirit and that you're yielded to Him. I would start smiling real quickly if I was you. I would have continued. Some of you continue to look like you're passing a kidney stone. I want to pray for you. That is the case. I want to pray for you. I believe God for you to get healed. And it's just hard to smile when you're in such excruciating pain. You know, we thought, well, we should go ahead and just start a school on how to be happy. People want to start a school on how to function the word of knowledge. You know what? I'm so glad you're so far ahead of us. We need to go to a class of just ha ha. We need to go to physical therapy to deal with the atrophy of our smile muscles. They're not working. Huh? Many people look like they're paralyzed. You know, when they try to, it just come on. I want to just help break this thing down for you that Jesus uses in the context to describe what it looks like to be saved, what it looks like to be born again, what it looks like to be made a new creation, what does it look like to be made a new creature, what does it look like to have received the light of life, what does it look like that you have come and drinking of the water that He supplies. This is the context, extraordinary joy and rejoicing. It's chief in the ministry of who Jesus, is what He did. Because the Scripture describes to us that God has anointed Him with the oil of joy above all of His companions. Well, He lives in me. I mean, I've been given His life. I've been given his life. The new creation brought to me the ability to live His life. Is now He doesn't have the oil of joy anymore? Lord, what happened? No, it said He's not master and ruler and Lord. Something else is. Something else has conflicted you and compromised you. Something else has stolen your affections away. And Paul said, listen, you can't set your affections on things of this earth. All it's going to do is compromise you. It's going to conflict you. I'm going to tell you right now, if you get your confidence and your hope and your trust in things that are earthly, it's so temporal. Yeah. True. you get your trust and your hope in man, you're going to be so tossed to and fro with every wave and wind of doctrine and every trick of men. God wants to cause you to, he wants to lift you up into a realm of his divine power and glory. That's what this new life is all about. It's a transcendent life. It's a heavenly life. It's the life of walking in the Spirit. That's walking in God, the Holy Ghost, living in him, moving in him, having our actions, our appetite, our attitude, living, walking, being led by him. You could use the word control there. And if you don't want to use the word control, then use the word rule and parse them, please. And I understand why we might want to back away from control, because that smacks of a dictator. Rule, Father's going to let you voluntarily cooperate. But if you're not cooperating, he's not ruling. It's a relationship thing that God has given to us. And when we think about the oil of joy, that he has anointed him with the oil of joy, do we have to also understand that that then is a synonym for what else he anointed Jesus with? He anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and power. Who went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil. I mean, I tell you right now, you get a little bit more joy, you're going to have a little bit more power expressed in your life. You begin to yield yourself a little bit more to the character and the nature, hallelujah, and the demeanor and the divine expression. Father isn't looking for part-time Christians. And by and large, many people who attend church aren't even part-time Christians. And if you had to make a living off as much time as you invest into God, my goodness, you'd be dead already. You'd starve and not have a place to live in. You'd be worse off than the people than the worst, poorest third world country that there is. When the Lord told us to give all attendance, give a 100% focus on making our calling and election sure. Amen. To seeing as we've been given the divine nature to add to our faith, virtue or excellence of character or purity and self-control and knowledge and brotherly kindness and godliness and walking in humility and giving ourselves to lowliness and meekness and just yielding to God and not yielding to persecution and not yielding to threats, but yielding to blessings. Amen. You start trusting in God, you won't need the court to decide no more. You start trusting in God, you won't need the doctor to sign anymore. Huh? You start trusting in God, you won't need to spend so much money on lawyers. God will give you wisdom and to get fixed. Hallelujah. No, you want to do it, you know, the way of flesh. You want to trust in the arm of flesh and be cursed. Shame on you. Why don't you start trusting in the Lord, make him the sole object of your trust so that you can be blessed. Because trust in the arm of flesh is an evident token that your heart is wicked and deceitful. True, if you want to understand, if you want to exegete Jeremiah chapter 17, then that's true. You trust in the arm of flesh, your heart's wicked and deceitful. Mine's not. My heart's been purified, been washed, been cleansed. It's the temple of the throne room of the Almighty God. I've been empowered to make him the sole object of my trust. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I feel like dancing yet. I've been, because really, the reality of it is not about what I've done. It's he's empowered me to make him the sole object of my trust. All I did was agree with God. All I did was say, no, I'm not having those things in my life. The Lord gently speaks to me and says, no, I don't want you to have that stuff in your life. And we might sit around, oh, Lord, everybody else gets to do it. Father, it seems like fun. He said, I'm telling you, it's not fun. It's robbing you. It's stealing from you. I just can't even believe it, Lord. I thought you loved me and cared about me. Why is it I got to not get to have the fun and everybody else? Kicking the can like the little kid. And the Lord says, no. I'm telling you this because I really want you to have fun. I want you to enjoy the pleasures that are in my presence. I want you to begin to be thrilled with the glory of divine authority and power. I mean, think about it. As sonship in a new birth, he gave us the authority to be sons of God. The authority to be sons of God, that's a pretty powerful authority. Hello. That's kind of authority the angels desire to look into. They desire to know this. They could be classically called sons of God, but not like you and I are called sons of God.
Because you and I are made in Christ Jesus, the eternal God. We're made in Him. We are in Him. We only exist by Him. We are in Him and He's in us. And that is a radical thing. You've got to get divine revelation. You've got to yield to the Holy Ghost to even begin to appreciate that, much less believe it. And that's why you're going to see me. I'm not going to be happy just watching people sing a few little songs. I mean, praise God, whatever it is that you're honoring the Lord, that's good. Bless your heart. But the Lord wants it to be deeper than that. He wants it to come not just in a framework of a human expression. He wants it to be something that only the Holy Ghost can produce. And you and I got to be trained to do that. Somebody's got to be willing to be in the house that are going to give themselves to perfecting the saints. Yeah, right. For building up the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. To equipping God's people to say, quit, stop it, enough with what you can do in the realms of the human framework. Amen. Lay hold on what God has supplied. Get to a place now where there's a flow of heaven through your life. And no, it shouldn't take half the meeting to get it done, but by and large, do you know, I've been in the church all of my life. Do you know how many altar calls I've been involved in? Do you know how many people I've watched come and do the same altar call over and over again? You know how many mass crusades I have been a part of all over the world, watching tens of thousands of people basically not get closure with God? They keep coming back for the salvation, the altar call, to try to get right with God, to try to get filled with the Spirit, to try to move forward with it. People, it's your decisions. It's simply accepting what He's given. And it being the best thing that you've ever had the opportunity to have. And you have all these things, you know, you're carrying all these things, you got all this stuff, you know, and you got your arms wrapped around it, and it's so important to you, and you're clutching it, and then all of a sudden you see this one beautiful thing, and you drop it all, and you grab a hold of this, and you don't let go. That's what it's like. That people are trying to juggle all this stuff, but still reach out there and get a, grab a hold of it, and then they gotta work. And this, many people looked at it like that in church. Let's look at the body of Christ. Holding on to their stuff. Trying to lay hold on eternal life. It's a total transformation of life. It's a total change of nature. That miraculously comes to us that then we have to be willing to submit to. Because you can have a miracle transformation of nature and change. But you still have, within the framework of your will, the ability to leave that great miraculous event and go be a part of the demonic. God's not going to say that you can't. God's not going to force you to love Him and force you to obey Him. And it's not like that Satan somehow is just going to submit to God. He's been a rebel about everything else, but he's going to submit to God on your case and on your account? No, he doesn't believe a single person on the earth is saved. He believes that every human being belongs to Him. He believes He can make every man curse God. If he's allowed to get at us, somebody's going to have to rise up and say, about how, begin to speak and live out and testify about how they feel concerning what Christ Jesus did for them. When He bore our own sins in His body on the tree, that we now, being dead to sin, might live unto righteousness, by whose wound we were healed, who bore in His own flesh and in His own body that realm of our iniquity, and brought to us this glorious salvation, so that now we are unreprovable, unrebukable, without blame before Him, holy and without blame, unreprovable and unrebukable in His sight. Did somebody say, is that even in the scripture? Yeah, it's Colossians 1:22. It's God just testifying to this so great a salvation that has been given to us that people are having a hard time getting happy about. They're having a hard time getting excited about. You're juggling too many things. You need to get more. The Lord wants to bring you into a little bit more focus. He wants to show you how to just grab a hold of today, tonight, a place of praise and worship, a place of thanksgiving that causes you to become excessively happy. Because that's where you're going to learn the joy. You're not going to learn the joy because your car is all polished. You're not going to have to try to keep the joy because somebody now dented your car that you just polished. Because who even stinking cares about your dent in your car? That your joy would be on such a thin footing that it is taken away by a dent in your car? We need to reevaluate what kind of joy we got. That your favorite television program got canceled because there's a special news report and you all up in explosive arms? The joy is completely taken from you? It's nuts. We need to redefine joy here. Joy is a product of fellowship and communion with the Almighty God. Joy is a product and a result that the living God now is on the inside of you and being expressed through the attitudes, emotions, and affections of your life. That He brings to you excessive happiness.
Amen.
And it's like a river. It's more than a spring. It's more than a spring. You know, and if you can talk to me about springs, I like 3,000 to 5,000 gallon per minute springs. I've got a new standard to springs. Okay, you with me? No, give me no 30 gallon per minute springs. You can't do much with them. I want 3,000 to 5,000 gallon artesian springs minimum. Can you imagine? Hallelujah! God's people being a wellspring of life and expression of His love and His joy and of His goodness and the gifts of the Spirit. This is what God demands. And the only issues that we're having is the places where we won't agree with them and submit to them. I know we want to blame it on God. Change the theology so that it accommodates our experience. But it ain't going to work. It isn't going to work. In the mighty name of Jesus tonight, I pray that you get so real with God that you'll shut down the nonsense. You shut down the nonsense. Shut it down. If it's not in heaven, you don't want it. If it isn't about heaven, you don't want it. If it isn't something that Jesus brought to us and purchased it for us at Calvary, you don't want it. If it isn't something supplied by the Holy Ghost, you don't want it. If it isn't truth, you don't want it. So let me just try to back up here, just kind of define a little bit for you just on joy. Are you with me?
Yes.
Leviticus 23, verse 40. The Lord's talking about the Feast of Tabernacles. He says, you should take on the first day and bring branches of goodly trees, branches of palm trees, branches of thick trees, willows of the brook. You should rejoice before the Lord your God for 7 days. You're going to take plants. Not hydrophobic plants. Not plants of the desert, but hydrophilic plants. Plants that are absolutely dependent upon an excessive amount of water. And what they would do is they would rejoice before the Lord, speaking of the wilderness of their life, having been made a new creation and become a Garden of Eden. That's what the Lord's done for us spiritually, our life. When Isaiah is talking about this, you know, when Jesus said, as the Scripture said, He was talking about verses of Scripture like in Isaiah 29, Isaiah 32, Isaiah 35, Isaiah 45. You know, there's so many verses of Scripture where He's talking about that He'll bring forth pools of water in the desert. He'll bring wellsprings of life would break forth in the wilderness. And where there was the briar and where there was the thorn, there shall be the myrtle tree and the fig tree. And all these things that was a testimony of our lives becoming like a fruitful Garden of Eden, a place with every good and wonderful plant growing there, pertaining, rather speaking of the very life and quality of the character and the nature of the living God. That everything is that which He ordained it to be when He created Adam in His image and in His likeness. And it's even beyond that because we've not been restored to a place that Adam was in. We've been brought into this place in Christ Jesus, the eternal God made flesh, who's now seated at the right hand of God the Father, and we're seated with Him in the heavenly realm.
Amen.
Having been highly exalted together with Him in a place that is far above all principality, the power of my dominion. And that's just sonship. That's just new birth authority. That's just new birth authority. We've not even been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire yet. was telling somebody recently, I said, you know, I wouldn't be so aggravated if we didn't have Holy Ghost and fire. Because what I'm sitting around doing is I'm expecting people to function in the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire like the Bible describes, and I'm frustrated. Because I don't see it happening. I mean, if we just leave it to a bunch of people who've been born again and they're newborn babes and who knows how long it's going to take for them to ever have any kind of sign of growth, then fine, leave it there. Because everybody can praise the Lord, thank you, Lord Jesus, we love you, Lord, and dealing with all my trials and afflictions and all my troubles and problems and issues. And I'm learning how to just lay hold on faith and not let all these things be so big to me and so impactive in my life. Then maybe I could deal with it. But the Lord's got to bring baptism, Holy Ghost, and fire into the program. You know, I think I could be happy with God's people. I'm just going to be transparent with you for a little while. I think I could be happy with the church and its state if it was just nothing more that you've been set free, you've been born again, you're alive from the dead. Now you're growing in grace, and every day you've got to be taught by the ministry and by the Spirit of the living God and by the way you connect and by the way that you hook up with the things of the Spirit, how to now move and function and flow in the life of Jesus. I think I could be happy. I think. Because, I mean, there's things going on that still is, in many respects, as I see it across the landscape of the church, that doesn't look anything like the life of Jesus. Because I'm going to talk about the life of Jesus. I'm going to talk about the oil of joy above everybody else. I'm going to talk about the life of Jesus. I'm going to talk about lowliness and meekness. I'm going to talk about the life of Jesus. I'm going to talk about everything that's heavenly. I'm going to talk about the life of Jesus. I'm not going to see any greed or pride or envy or strife or debate, all that stuff. I'm not going to see it. It's not going to be there. But then the Lord puts baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire on this thing. And he tells us what the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire is going to result in and what kind of people it's going to produce. And it doesn't take some year. It's instantaneously. Peter goes from one person, as it were, to a whole other dimension of divine expression and glory in his life. What's happened is God's people have not been willing to surrender at all. They've not been willing to consecrate their life to just sitting in his presence, bathing in his peace for hours on end. Just sitting there, saturated with the glory, the divine presence of the living God. God, heaven, the reality of the working of the Holy Spirit has not become that effective in our life, and the change has got to come. Yeah. It's got to come. Yeah. And it's only going to come in your life because you get intense about it. It's only going to come in your life because you become hungry. There's nothing so intense as hunger. Fast for a couple of days. We do fast around here at different times. Fast with us. Fast for 21 days. If you forgot how intense hunger is. Go without water for 48 hours. Find out how passionate you are and how intense you are about a drink. And, you know, and the Lord doesn't necessarily... You know, want us to, he doesn't, it's not like we're producing that. It's just that's what he puts within us this capacity to be hungry for what he wants to supply, because what he has is so sacred. And he's not going to just allow it to be another little thing on our shelf. Okay, right now I'm going to do this one. Now I'm going to go enjoy this one. Now I'm going to go enjoy this one. And then we put those back on the shelf. And now, hey, Jesus, how about you for a little while? Let's hang out for a little while. I mean, I don't have a lot of time. Because you know I got an appointment here in about 30 minutes. But let's go for it for a while. What you think? Jesus is not going to be one of your little demigods. He's not going to be one of your idols in your life. The thing that he has is just too sacred. He's invited you and I to be heirs together of God. Co-inheritors together with him. To function and flow in all the realms of his life and his glory. And that should be the most valuable thing to us. And what I want to be able to do is present Jesus Christ to you in such a way that you no longer identify with your former conversation, the old man that was under a death penalty of destruction and damnation, but you only identify with a new creation, a new man that has been created in us by this miracle work of the Holy Ghost who came upon you and brought forth this wonderful thing of God. A new heart and a new spirit, new attitudes, new appetites, new desires, new wants. to where the Father would develop you in faith. I mean, Father, you know, Father says, I believe that if people would just take Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 6, and Matthew chapter 7, and they would start living that, their whole life would be changed. First and foremost, if you give yourself to live in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, you're going to find how desperate you are for the Holy Spirit, the life-giving flow of the Holy Spirit to live the life of Jesus, which is salvation. That's a salvation anointing. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Yes. He's going to tell you to take no thought for what you shall eat.
Yeah.
Now start doing that. For how long, Lord? Like, can I get through a day? That I'm not going to be concerned how I'm going to pay for this. Take no thought for what you shall wear. And he's giving us a challenge. He's giving us a trust challenge. Because it all comes back to trust. That's where Adam failed. He wouldn't trust God. God said, just do this. And he wouldn't trust God. He wouldn't trust God. Abraham was willing to trust God, and look at what he inherited. Jesus personified trust. Look at who he is. Now he lives in me. Now I can live by him. There is a realm in which I can live by him, but I got to quit living by myself. I got to quit doing things of myself and by myself. I got to quit ministering to the realms of that which is wrong. The more I give myself to sorrow and sadness, the more I give myself to being upset because somebody corrected me. And there's some people, if I tell them what's really going on in their life, they'd be crushed. It'd take them 2 months to get over it. Why? Because there's so much fear in their life, and there's so much need for the approval of men in their life. And I just got to kind of go easy with it. And otherwise, you just got to just talk in generalities, you know, and not look at anybody too long. So that no one gets hurt and offended because of fear. And that's all the realms of darkness. That's not the realms of the Spirit. I mean, you guys should be sitting up on the edge of your seat saying, let the righteous smack me.
Amen.
I want the Lord to sort me out. I want to get... I want, and somebody says to you, listen, you're not getting it. You're not even beginning to move in what God wants for you. You should say, hey, man, I want to. Help me out here. I want to get this. Rather than going, I knew he didn't like me. I can't believe it. I can't do anything right. It's just amazing. No matter what I do, there's no getting it right. That's so sad, isn't it? Because nowhere else in life have you ever been trained to succeed with that kind of response.
Right.
But we get around the Lord Jesus, and we all turn into a bunch of little suckling babies. You know what I'm saying? Why? Because the spirit of offense, Satan uses the spirit of offense to shut people down. And if you don't know how to resist those things, it's going to overtake you and deceive you and blockade you from the blessings of God. I mean, we want, I want to be your disciple. I said, no, you don't. He said, yeah, I do. I said, no, you don't. Believe me, you don't. I said, you can't even handle an hour of a church meeting with me. You can't take it. You just can't take it. Might as well live in denial over there. So then even more intense is the Lord Jesus wants us to be his disciples. And of course, you know, the Lord has commanded me and everybody who's a leader in his church to make disciples out of nations. I'm supposed to make disciples out of you. But we first got to basically lay out the conditions. And say, you know what? It's better for so many people to just stay over there, to stay there in the category of we're deciding whether or not we want to be disciples. Stay over there. Because we don't want to put you through something that's more than you can handle. Maybe if you just keep listening after a while. How many agree with that? I don't agree with any of it. I believe I need to put the pressure on you in a big kind of way. Huh? And hold you responsible for everything that God's commanded you to do. And so that's what I do. Obviously, I'm not a facilitator. Did anybody notice that? Did anybody notice I wasn't struggling? Man, I hope they like what I'm getting ready to say now. I hope everybody agrees and gets happy with what I'm going to say now. No, I'm going to lay out for you what Christ Jesus has given us the opportunity to do, how he's given us the opportunity to live, and then tell you that this is what God demands and that you better change or you're not right.
Yeah.
And it's about time that you get up in the morning, quit practicing being unhappy and all consumed with whatever it is that you think you're doing in this world. With all of your business activities and issues. Why don't you put God first, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then don't be concerned about all these other things. Let the Lord provide for you. Let him bless you. Let him establish you. Let him promote you. Let his favor rest upon you. Look at Joseph. Look at Jacob. Joseph's father. Look at everyone who in any level put God first, an honored father, and was an ambassador of the kingdom and a representative of a person who's in covenant relationship with God. They weren't forsaken. They didn't go without. They were blessed. They were highly favored of God. The favor of God was upon them. You'll do whatever it is that you're doing far better when the Spirit of Truth is right in the middle of it. You're letting God evaluate every part of your life. I'm going to try to get over here and talk about joy just a little bit. How many of you know if you're going to rejoice, you've got to have a lot of joy in it? Does anybody believe that you can rejoice without being joyful? Does anybody believe you can praise without being thankful?
No.
Does anybody believe that you can be thankful without being happy?
No.
Thank you. We're off to a great start, running start here. So now that everybody clearly understands what we're supposed to be doing, I hope that everyone will do that from here on in.
Yeah. Yeah.
That you recognize that available to you is a glory and a joy and a thanksgiving.
Yes.
And a happy, so that you can stand there in the presence of the Lord and worship him.
Yes.
and praise his holy name and yield to the works of the Holy Ghost in your life. Listen, dear people, don't hide from God. Don't sneak around, because we got your ticket. I've got all the messages that we're going on. We know where you've been on the internet. We have a secret app. Anyone who walks in here, we know where you've gone and visited on the internet. We know everything about you. Big Brother is watching. His name is Jesus. He is our elder brother. He's involved in everything that's going on. He searches out every matter concerning us. He wants, for the purpose of establishing in this truth, I said no lies. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I said no lies.
No lies.
People want to hook up with the truth. People want to flow in the Holy Ghost. Brother, you're going to have to hook up with the truth, because he's the Spirit of Truth.
Yeah.
He's not going to play pretend. Yeah. It's just a time. If you're sad and sorrowful, repent.
Yeah.
Repent. It wasn't my fault. Yes, it's your fault. Yeah. You're yielding your members to it. If you're sad and sorrowful, repent and become joyful and glad.
Yeah.
The redeemed of the Lord have returned and come with singing unto Zion. Now, are you redeemed? Then
yeah.
You've returned.
Amen.
Where?
Yeah.
Back to God. And
Amen.
You come with singing unto Zion. What is Zion? It's the heavenly realm. Praise God. Hallelujah. The redeemed of the Lord have returned and come with singing unto Zion. Everlasting, everlasting.
Joy.
Is on their
head.
Where at? On like, where at on your head? Where at on your head? Where at on your face? Is on your face. Face is on your face. And so therefore, I'm going to conform to his word. I'm going to agree with him. I'm going to say, Lord, and if I don't have that, I'm going to say, Lord, I want that. I want that. I'm tired of living unhappy and depressed and sorrowful. That is demonic oppression. That is demonic oppression. That is demon power. Oh, my ancestors are melancholy. Yeah, well, God came to deliver you from your ancestral heritage. God came and regened you, man. He washed you with the water of regening. Yes, he did. Titus 3:5, he washed you with the water of regening. Regeneration. Hallelujah. You can't get cleaner than being regenerated. Hallelujah. You can scrub up all you want with soap. But you're not going to get as clean as you are when you begin become a new creation, regenerated, redeemed. Hallelujah. New parentage, new genealogy, a direct issue of the Almighty God having been begotten of God, having been begotten of the Word of God. Wow. Boy, God, the Lord has just got us off to a strong start.
Amen.
We're just off to a good start. We're not having to work our way out of the bad to somehow have the good. He just took all the bad away and set us in good land.
Amen.
Amen. So that we can begin to rejoice in Him. Tomorrow you got to practice rejoicing.
Yes.
You got to practice being glad.
Yes.
You got to be practicing. And then say, Lord, I want an excessive joy.
Yes.
I want the kind that only you can bring when I touch heaven. Because I'm telling you, there is a realm of interaction and communion with God that causes a supernatural, something superior to the natural, of divine glory and power to flow into you and flow out of you. And so that's why Paul said, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And being filled with the Spirit is equivalent to being baptized in the Holy Ghost. You know, Jesus said in Acts 1:5 and 1:8, you should be baptized in the Holy Ghost. And in Acts 2:4, when it happened, he said they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Proof that baptism and filled is just not synonymous. People, theologians sit around for years arguing the difference between what does it mean to be filled and baptized, breaking out every Hebrew word and Greek word, and I can answer it inside of 2 minutes. By what the Word of God describes. Just be baptized. Be continually filled. Be overwhelmed with the Holy Ghost. Let the Word of God, let the Word of Christ, what He has said, what He's spoken to us in His Word, what He's revealed to us in this relationship with Him, dwell in you richly. And what is going to produce? What's that going to produce? It's going to pray. It's going to produce praise. It's going to produce psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, an excessive display of joy. You're going to start dancing in your living room. You might start laughing. You get up in the morning. If you get up in the morning and you do what you have done for so many years, you're going to have the same results. Hello. You get up in the morning and stand in front of your mirror and start dancing around. First thing is you're going to start laughing at yourself. And if anybody else is around, even if it's your spouse, you're going to feel a little awkward. And laugh a little bit more at yourself. But you shouldn't be awkward. You should be rejoicing, God, here you have another day, another opportunity to prepare for the greatest meeting that you will ever have. Your meeting, your face-to-face meeting with God Almighty. To get ready, you're being prepared for that wedding day when you're going to step in front of Him and, as it were, be married unto God at the marriage supper of the Lamb, to start functioning in a realm that we can't even expressly talk about right now, because of what the seven thunders uttered has been sealed up until that day. And that was in the context of the kingdom of this world to become the kingdom of our God and of His Christ. And He has made us priests and kings, and we shall reign with Him forever. That's the context of the seven thunders. Don't tell them yet. Don't tell them. Seal it up. They've got enough to deal with. They've got to learn to be happy. They've got to learn to choose heaven instead of hell. They've got to learn to choose the realms of the Holy Spirit instead of demon spirits. They've got to learn to choose the good and refuse the evil. What person in their right mind would curse themselves? But yet, men do it continually with agreeing with the wrong things and yielding their members to the wrong things. Oh, Father wants us. Father, in His mercy and His grace, has truly liberated us and put us in control so that we may submit ourselves to His rulership and authority over life and say no to every demon power. He doesn't come and say no on our back. I said, leave him alone. Like, you know, you you go to some place and somebody said, if you go to that place, man, find the biggest guy, make friends with him so he can be your bodyguard. Right? No. Jesus had come to be our bodyguard. He's strengthened us, and He's empowered us to look Satan right square in the face and say, no, you foul spirit of hell, I take complete and total authority over you in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm having nothing to do with you. And then all heaven is mobilized to back us up. So Satan's looking at us. He's not really looking at us. He's looking at what's all standing behind us. All heaven's army. And Christ Jesus, captain of our salvation, is at the head of it. And his eyes are a flame of fire. So there's nothing Satan can do. The Lord says, submit yourself to God. Submit yourself to God. How do you do that? It's in this place of yielding to the Holy Ghost, letting this wonderful gift of salvation flow through your appetites and your attitudes and your emotions. Start off with dancing in the morning. Get up and dance in the morning. The secret to Smith Wigglesworth's life. People love the fact that how Smith Wigglesworth operated in the great signs and wonders and miracles. He got up in the morning. He started this morning dancing around in his room, dancing before the Lord, getting all excited. Then he went to communion after that. He's touching heaven. He was living in it. He gave us a model of what does it look like to live over in this place of communion in the Holy Ghost. Yeah. And people, it isn't some kind of a legalistic lifestyle, some kind of a weird kind of fringy lifestyle. It's a different kind of way to live. It's living after the realms of the Spirit. It's living after the realms of heaven. Yeah. All the rest of that, which we call normal and ordinary and common, that we don't feel awkward, really is the awkward. It is really not the ordinary, and it shouldn't be the common. It's a world of darkness, and the Lord has come to give us light. All of us who were born blind, He's come. He's opened up our eyes with the waters of life, with the waters, the wellspring of life, with the water that flows from the throne of God. Hallelujah! Which is what the pool of Siloam represents. It's the wellspring. It's the Nabo. It's the spring that bubbles up. Like I said, it became early on equated after it was brought in to the inner wall of the city by Hezekiah. It became that from that day on, that it existed all the way back to David's day, but that spring did. But it ultimately became far more associated by the time of Hezekiah with what ultimately would begin to be expressed that was written down and described by Ezekiel in Ezekiel chapter 47. It began to be connected with this river, this stream that makes glad the city of God that David prophesied about. That then, of course, Ezekiel goes into far more details. Of course, after the days of Hezekiah, but into far more detail that we read about in Ezekiel 47, which is an expression of what's coming out of you and me. The throne of heaven set up in me. Christ is in me. God, the Holy Ghost is in me. I'm his dwelling place. I'm his temple. See, that's letting the word of Christ dwell in you richly. What's that going to do? It's going to start producing some psalms and hymns. And spiritual songs. It's going to start producing praise and thanksgiving. You'll turn the TV off. You'll turn your TV off. You'll cancel hell's box office. You no longer subscribe to Sin to the Max. Yeah, because people pervert themselves because you're involving your members in lasciviousness, and it's a death penalty sin. And you don't recognize it, that you're spiritually conflicted, and so you don't repent for it, so you'll die in your sins. Because you've been compromised by your culture and deceived by the spirit of darkness. And so you can't enter in. Oh, you telling this the movie's bad? Yes, I am. When it's got lasciviousness and adultery, and it's ultimately bringing you to a place of wanting revenge and wanting to see somebody killed and murdered, all those things, it's working as real, even though it's vicarious by a movie, it's working as real. You're yielding your members to it. It's an affection. It's an emotion that is being stirred up in you. Movies are designed. We know this because we understand the industry. They are designed to lure you in through lasciviousness, through the activity of lasciviousness. Your members, your spiritual person has to engage with lasciviousness if you are involved in movies produced by Hollywood. It's designed that way. The tobacco companies and the liquor companies primarily sponsored most of the early movies, and that's why everybody's drinking and smoking.
Because now you're watching your favorite movie star drink and smoke, and what has happened is seed you. You got to go get some. If you're going to be John Wayne, the tough guy, you know, whatever, because that happens. People, I'm going to tell you right now, you don't understand how fragile your psychological state is, how easy it is for your mind to play tricks on you. God's given us the opportunity to have the mind of Christ.
Amen.
And then I've got to suffer persecution for this, but I'm happy to do so. God's given us the opportunity to have the mind of the Spirit. God's given us opportunity to live by the Word of God. To by the Word of God, let the Word of God be to us a shield of faith that quenches every fiery dart of the wicked one. So no sin can even touch us. No, Christians want today have a doctrine, a theology that we're going to sin more or less every day. That is antichrist spirit. It's no place to be, no place to be confirmed in the Word of God. It's a lie. It's a deception. It's a sign of the time that men will not endure sound doctrine, but will give themselves to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, having itching ears, wanting to have a demonic lifestyle confirmed as being right with God. It will never be. The 17 works of the flesh are listed out in Galatians chapter 5 simply so people can come to recognize those things that are proof that you're not yielded to the Holy Ghost and walking with God. That's why they're there. God has empowered us to walk rather in the realms of His life. And he lays out for us the dimensions of what it looks like to walk in the Holy Ghost and what are the fruits of the Spirit so that we have evidence and confirmation. Oh, wow, that's why I'm so joyful. I tell Ann when I said, sweetheart, you're just going to have to dial down the joy. Everybody's going to think you're nuts. They're going to think you're drunk. They're going to think something's wrong with you because we were getting on the plane and she was excessively joyful. And I wasn't. She was more caught away in the realms of the Spirit than I was. And I was being more mindful of people just like looking at us. Usually I'm not as mindful, you know. They're like, those guys are... It's heaven. What do you mean heaven? It's just some strange doctrine. Father is so desperate. He hastens to perform His word in us. God watches over His word to perform it. He watches over His word to hasten in us. Listen, Father wants you to be able to get up in the morning and touch heaven and live in the realms of heaven all day. To live under the reign of Christ Jesus. To live in the messianic age. This isn't a time of darkness where no man can work. Because Jesus Christ is right here. He is the light of the world right now. Amen. There's going to come a day where there is darkness and no man can work. There's going to come that day that Jesus referred to in John chapter 9 and verse 3. There's going to come that day, but it's not that day right now. There will be a day where only the wrath of God is going to be poured out upon the nations because they will have rejected God's grace and His mercy one too many times. Father, in His excessive love for us, came in the midst of a people who hated Him and who reject Him and live in strife and envy and all the hellacious things that people do on a daily basis that ultimately cause human beings to like dogs more than humans, kind of thing. Animal lovers unite. The Lord came down in the midst of it, and God so loved us that He gave us His only begotten Son. That whosoever would believe on Him, and believing is a change of life. Definition of believing, that John sets it out in the Gospel of John and defines it in the first epistle, in his first epistle, in such a radical way that believing is living the very life of God. That if you say that you know Him and you walk in any kind of darkness or you have sin in your life, you're a liar. There is no one more radical about it. And there is a goodness of God and a grace of God that if we sin, if we do, not when we do, but if we somehow drift over into a compromise with the spirit of this world, to be friends with the world, to like the things in the world, love not the world, don't like the things of the world either. Yes. Huh? Because love and liking God are the same. Yeah.
God doesn't parse out love. You either love or you hate. So if it's a like, it's got to be defined as love.
Right.
And you can't love anybody without liking them, and you can't like anybody without loving them. Are you with me? I like them, but I don't love them. I love them, but I don't like them. Which is more common? You hear that one? Oh, I love my, especially among siblings. Oh, I love my sibling, but I don't like him. You don't love him. You're carrying around some kind of a problem, some kind of an offense, some kind of unforgiveness, some kind of a distortion of what really happened. You need to let the rivers of the healing waters of heaven flow through that part of your life and let God bring healing to you. So you know what the love of God will do for you? He'll make a foot washing slave out of you. He'll make a foot washing slave out of you. People are going to go to church tonight because they, I went to church and somebody did such and such. Now those people over there, they don't really show you the love of God. You know what? Those people don't have a problem with God's people. They have a problem with God, because as soon as your relationship gets right with God, he'll so fill you with love that you won't care about any problems or issues or what people do to you. Nothing shall be able to offend you. You'll have perfect peace.
Amen.
Because when Christ Jesus comes, he comes loving those who are alienated by wicked works. He comes loving those who persecute him and threaten him and hate him.
Sure.
Huh?
Yes.
He comes laying down his life for those who are in such a state. And everybody who knows him does the same.
Yeah.
And those who do not know him don't do the same. Those who are religious do what Pharisees do. Pharisees and Sadducees. And the Pharisees were just as sad as the Sadducees. Even though they acted like they joy. They danced all night to the light of the world and got up the next day and started telling him he was demon possessed. It's what happens when you stay up all night. No, it's what happens when you're blinded, spiritually blind. I'm not able to really get over to talk too much about that tonight and this that I wanted to bring to you, because I'm just going to give to you what you need, and you better do something with it.
Yes.
Amen.
You better do something with it.
Yes.
You better do something with it. We give you an opportunity to start flowing in the Holy Ghost and giving thanks. It's just need to yield your members to it. And the more you'll give yourself to it Monday, Tuesday, the better you'll be able to do it on Wednesday night when Evangelist Tim Hall's here.
Yeah.
And, you know, he is a crack up. I mean, he's a mighty man of God. I mean, I've been with him in crusades of 50,000 plus people. He has some of the biggest crusades in Asia, in the South Pacific. But, you know, he gets here and he's at home. He's with family. But you know what? You just get Tim to settle down. And I'm telling you right now, signs and wonders and miracles will break out. And I just pray that you'll come laying hold on the signs and the wonders and the miracles that are demonstrated to the man of God's life. He's only going to be, I was thinking about having him do Wednesday and Thursday night, but he's running so hard, you know, I just wanted him to rest, hang out with Daniel and Summy on Thursday night. Nobody really put the press on me to have two nights of meetings, so I just left it. I'm not kidding. Not so blessed silence. Deuteronomy 12:7 talks about meeting with the Lord too. He says, "And there shall you eat before the Lord, and you shall rejoice in all that you put your hand into. You and your household, wherein the Lord your God has blessed you." What you're going to find about rejoicing is, If I stood here tonight and I read just the verses of Scripture that are right along this line, there'd be 183 of them. If I pick up all the verses of Scripture on joy and rejoicing, then there's going to be over 560 of them, 564. You reckon the Lord could get his point across?
Yeah.
See, as I've done two from the Old Testament, let's just go quickly over here to the New Testament. I'll start on the back side of the New Testament, okay? And we'll work our way back up. Are you with me?
Yes.
So I won't go through Revelation. And so let's just look at this. 1 Peter 1:6. He says, wherein greatly, speaking of our salvation, wherein ye greatly rejoice. When's the last time you greatly rejoiced over your salvation? Not just rejoice. There's different levels here. There's rejoice. There's greatly rejoice. There's being exceedingly joyful. And there's joy unspeakable and full of glory. Those are different levels. Those are different dimensions. And all we want you to do is we want you to come begin to practice, understand what God the Holy Ghost is doing. This is what God the Holy Ghost is doing. Why don't you do it with him? Don't tell me you yield the Holy Ghost and you're not doing what he's doing, because that's just a farce. I want to understand what God the Holy Ghost is doing and do it with him. And I know what's going to happen is I'm going to greatly rejoice. I'm greatly rejoice. Wherein we greatly rejoice, having received the end of our salvation, wherein, having received the end of our salvation, that's the verse that comes before it, having received the end of our salvation, wherein we greatly rejoice, with joy, we greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, you're in heaviness through manifold temptation. Still, you're greatly rejoicing.
Amen.
So just because you're having a whole bunch of problems don't mean that you don't need to greatly rejoice. You get that?
Yes.
Anybody see that? Whom you have not seen yet believing, it's verse 8, whom you have not seen yet believing, whom you have not seen yet love, and whom though you see him now, not right now, you believe, and because you love him and because you believe, you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. So when's the last time you rejoiced with joy unspeakable and full of glory? Don't you understand that's what the Holy Ghost is doing in the midst of the church? So then you're going to have to practice, people practicing word of knowledge. I'm going to tell you right now, you need to practice rejoicing with joy unspeakable and full of glory first. And then your word of knowledge is going to be more accurate. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody said the meeting's gone too long. No, it really hasn't. It really hasn't. We've only gone 2.5 hours. I'm stretching out for 5.5, so get prepared. I learned from how to preach from the Apostle Paul. And people sit down and watch movies 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, back-to-back movies. It's a marathon movie-thon. Come to church. Well, man, you're like 2.5 hours. I'm feeling uncomfortable. I feel you strain, man. I'll break you out of that thing.
Amen.
So I need to go home and get my sleep. Your sleep hasn't done nothing for you up to this point. Try something new. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I mean, I tell you, those of you who have a problem memorizing verses of Scripture, try this one. I promise you, you will leave here tonight saying, I finally memorized a verse of Scripture. 1 Thessalonians 5:16, and most of you know what I'm talking about. The whole verse of Scripture is, rejoice evermore. The Lord wanted to keep it simple to make a point. He wanted to keep it simple to make a point. This is my praise. I mean, you just extended me beyond my limits of praise. I only have a capacity to praise for 10 minutes. What do you do for the rest of the 24 hours? If you praise for 10 minutes and that's your threshold, what's going on for the rest of the minutes? Are you with me?
Yes.
Come on. Rejoice evermore. It's good every minute, isn't it? Can you go? But how about my tribulation? How about the situations where I get in? I'm just taxing of, well, rejoice. You know, my wife and I gave ourselves to excessive joy. Excessive joy? Because we gave ourselves to excessive love, because we gave ourselves to Jesus. We gave ourselves to a place of yield to the Holy Ghost. And one of the beautiful things that's happened is every time some great catastrophe or disaster tried to happen in our life, we just were overwhelmed with joy. We didn't have to try to be happy. We weren't like, okay, we've got to yield ourselves to joy now, rejoice in the Lord. You know, we're going to just praise our way through this. No. We already did all of that. We constantly, through all the situations and all the trials and all the issues that we had to go through, pastoring for 32 years together, plus, not just pastoring, traveling and ministry, and all the other things. And you go through some stuff. Because as soon as you start preaching a gospel that I preach, about living in this wonderful relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, where you don't have to sin, where you don't have to live in ungodliness, where you can walk in the new creation, where you can walk in the new man, where you can live out the heavenly life in this wonderful place in the Holy Ghost, this divine expression of His nature in our life. Satan, you target Satan wants to take you down so he can invalidate the message, because there's not a lot of people preaching that. So we go through some stuff. But every place, we just found praise there. We just found joy there. We just always found Jesus right there. He was always right there. Holy Ghost was always right there. It wasn't like, oh, Holy Spirit, come back. I really need you now. He was always there. He never left. He never left. The wellspring was always springing.
Thank you, Lord.
I mean, if I went out to one of my wellsprings, one of my artesians, and it was no longer coming up, I mean, my goodness, what a devastating thing that would be. I've got a lot of trout, they're counting on that water. Living things are counting on that water. We come to you and we see you and there's no wellspring there. What a disaster. What a disaster. The moving of the Spirit of the Lord that is supposed to be being expressed through our life. But not, listen, the bottom line of it is you give yourself to this realm of heaven, this realm of joy. I mean, I love to talk about Anna. I know Anna's watching right now. There are new babies here. John Samuel, the man of God. I mean, they brought him home for the first time. He's a mighty man of God. You can see it all over him. He's just, you know, he's like 2 days old, 3 days old. You see anointing of God all over him. We just got back from Yanji, China, and the things that the Lord was doing in Asia, and just, wow, just amazing things were happening. And we get back and, you know, Allie's diagnosed with some crazy, you know, syndrome, and now she's going to die, and they think that she's going to die, and the baby's no way the baby's going to live, and it's just an emergency, and everybody's distressed, and, you know, it's the end of the world as far as they're concerned. Ann and I, we just got overwhelmed with a glory cloud of joy. I mean, when I went in there, they thought that I, you know, was someone that they, you know, they could talk to that had a little bit of background in clinical science and whatnot. But then after I got in there, they thought that they were contemplating dialing 911 or calling for security, because, you know, they thought I was drunk. I was just excessively joyous. They said, look at this vital signs, look at this and that's going on. I said, no problem. She's fine. No, you didn't hear me. This is what's going on. And I'm laughing now, you know. No, I'm telling you right now. She's fine, man. And they can't work that out. See, joy becomes a protection. Amen. No doubt, no unbelief, no fear can even get there.
Huh?
Faith works by love. Hey, perfect love casts out fear. Fear will shut down faith. Fear will listen, fear is an enemy of love. It's an enemy of faith. It's an enemy of all the things that Father has to give to us. Father, if we just give ourselves over to Him to say, Lord, I'm going to live in You, walk in You. I'm Your servant. I just want to be Your representative. I want to everywhere and everything that I do, I want to represent heaven. I don't want to represent nothing else. Heaven.
Heaven.
Heaven. Heaven. He'll take control. He'll take control. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Whew. Let's think about this. Rejoice evermore. Let's think about the Greek. No, we can't work our way out with the Greek language. Rejoice evermore. Well, that must be equivalent to praying without ceasing, which we've heard over and again, no one can do that. Have you heard that one? That is definably an antichrist spirit. Is somebody going to come and say that nobody can do what the Word of God just told you to do? You can't pray without it. That's got to be an antichrist. Is that a spirit of deception? That is demonic.
Yes.
Rejoice evermore. And the reality of it is Father is saying, are you willing to give yourself over to this realm? Do you know there's a place of communion and fellowship with God? There's a place where the rivers of life flow out of you, where it's not just ritual anymore. You're not just drawing water from the well of salvation. You know, you're not just going to a pool and exercising a ritualistic thing that says with joy we're drawing water from the wells of salvation, and they had to be excessively joyful when they did it. And now they're taking the palm branches and they're beating, striking the earth, and they're crying for this mystical realm of the Spirit of God to come forth and be released through the earth. And then I realized, wait a minute, hold up. You can find this in Sukkot, in the Mishnah, starting Sukkot, chapter 4, all the way to chapter 6, because they break it all down. This was the tradition. You're not going to find it biblically, but this was the tradition that was being exercised in the days of Jesus. And they understood that there was going to be this expression of the Holy Ghost that is going to be revealed, coming right up out of the earth. They didn't have an idea. So Jesus brings it all. He brings it all together for them. All of their mysticism and all their mystical expression and all their abstract concepts. He brings it all together for them when he says, come and I'll give you the water of life. And out of the earth, out of your earth, out of your belly, there is a treasure right now on the inside of you. If you've been born again, the power of God is right there to be accessed. God says he will give you all of his fullness that you get to understand. You get to grab a hold of and know this joy unspeakable. You get to know and understand and grab a hold of, lay hold of right now, this love of Christ which passes knowledge, to then to go and function in and live in the fullness, all the fullness of God. Now unto him who is super able to do super abundantly above all that you can think or ask according to the power that already exists in you.
Amen.
Right now. Right now. Somebody, first of all, what's happening is people are waiting for another day. Quit waiting for another day. Now. I see three people reacting to the anointing right now. Three people spiritually reacting to the anointing. The rest of you are intellectualizing things. And you're in different areas of submission to the Holy Ghost. Because too much of what God has said is still only in an intellectual realm. It's an information realm. And you don't know how to respond to the realms of the Spirit. And as far as I'm concerned, the people that are sitting in here, by and large, are a cut above what goes on in the Pentecostal movement. And, you know, I'm privileged enough by the Lord to get to see, you know, quite a display, you know, a representative of the landscape throughout the United States of America, especially of the Pentecostal movement. So you're going to have to learn how to... somebody said, well, I mean, we're in deep thought right now. Well, why don't you be in deep spirit right now? Why don't you just reach out? Why don't you let, as the Word of God's going forth, why don't you touch it? I mean, I'm talking about joy. And every once in a while, I give people a clap. Well, that is a worship. Clap your hands, oh, you people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. You know, that is a form of worship. But we really weren't ministering on, hold up. We weren't really ministering on clap your hands, oh, you people. We were ministering on joy that somebody thinks they're going to wait some other time. If you don't get it now, when are you going to have it? If you're not laying hold and moving and yielding to the realms of that which the Spirit of the Lord has supplied. Now the fruits of the Spirit are love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, meekness, temperance, faith. And there are no restrictions. Against this, there is no law. There are no limitations. God wants you to have these things excessively. Because tonight, what we're ministering on is Feast of Tabernacles. The kind of display of God's joy and rejoicing that he wants to accompany every time that any of his people come and meet with them, whether it's Pentecost, Passover, Sukkot, the three most important feasts. Yom Kippur wouldn't be in it. Yom Kippur wouldn't be in it. You hear me?
Yes.
The three most important celebrations to appear before him with joy. All shadows and types, speaking of this wonderful time where you and I would begin to be able to assemble ourselves as the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Those right now who are baptized by the Spirit into one body, the person of Jesus. Those who are right now baptized by the Lord Jesus Christ into the Holy Ghost. To be able to begin to express this life of Christ. Because understand, The body of Christ is only defined in context of the manifestation of the Spirit. It is not defined by Paul outside of the context of the manifestation of the Spirit. He defines the body of Christ in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 would be the first time that it appears in any of the things that Paul ministered. Colossians comes later. And he describes the body of Christ only in terms of the functioning of everyone, every single person moving in this wonderful glory, where one of you has a word of knowledge, another the word of wisdom, another discerning of spirits, another the working of miracles, another the gifts of healing, another the gift of faith, another prophecy, another tongues, another interpretation of tongues. And then within this framework, he describes the body of Christ. And then he ultimately brings it to the place of this wonderful display of the supernatural by the time you get to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And he says, how is it that every one of you hath a tongue? Every one of you hath a revelation. Every one of you can prophesy one by one. And he gives us the wonderful context of the Spirit of the Lord that has been poured out upon the church so that we may all prophesy. And the result of prophesying is that the secrets of each person who doesn't know the Lord, the secrets of their heart would be revealed, and falling down in our midst, they would say, truly God is in this place, not because of the songs that we sing, but because of the outworking and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost, because God's people have learned how to yield to the Spirit. Have you learned how to yield to God the Holy Ghost? And that was the means by which you could do it. The word of life goes forth. And upon the word, he sends forth his word, and he works miracles. He sends forth his word, and he heals. He sends forth his word, and he says to Peter, Peter says, speak the word only, bid me come to you. He says, come. And with the word, faith comes to Peter, and now he steps out and he begins to walk in the Spirit. He begins to move in the supernatural supply of heaven. So, your turn. No. You can't try. You don't try, you yield. Because these things will just happen. And these things will just happen. And so I'm making a point. Making a point. That God gives us a wonderful and a beautiful way to learn how to yield to Him. So that these things, you don't even ask for them, they just happen. You're just there, it's just a bubble up. It's not a pump that we install on you and mechanically draw it out. But you learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost through praise. You learn how to use the Holy Ghost through worship. And the Lord wants it to be continual. And when you look there in that wonderful, complicated verse of Scripture that I just referred to, it is made up of two words, rejoice evermore. We're talking about this. We're talking about a place of praising Him and giving thanks. Yeah. And delighting in God, not complaining, not murmuring, not being grumpy. Amen. Not arguing. Amen. Today, tonight, I want every person in this place, I want you to vow that you will never speak evil of anyone, ever. You'll never speak wrong about anyone. Because if you do, your lips are defiled and your spirit is defiled. And now because people have become so deceived, they get defiled with unholy things and they don't repent. Because it's normal to them. Think about it. Why don't you just consecrate yourself to the ways of God? Because if you listen to me, and this is the bigger point. I'm driving home. I'm painting you in a corner, driving something home. You yield your members to the realms of sin and iniquity, to the realms of the demonic, to complaint, to strife, to envy, to speaking evil of other men. There is no way you can be yielded to the Holy Ghost. You can't be until you repent. You've got to recognize it. You've got to repent. God, in His mercy and His grace, He will liberate you from that demonic oppression. You could say, oh, well, I love the Lord. I love God more than anybody I know. You can say whatever you want to say. But the reality of it is if you love Him, you're going to obey Him.
True.
And if you, because God's kingdom works off relationship. Yeah. There's nothing like it. There's nothing that models it. It's not a divine theocracy. There's nothing like it.
True.
It's a kingdom that functions off of relationship. We obey Him because we love Him.
Yeah.
Amen.
But if you've yielded yourself, if you're yielding yourself to the complaint, to the murmur, to the speaking evil of people, to accusations, Father wants you to bless.
Amen.
He doesn't want you to curse.
That's right.
He wants you to bless so that you can inherit a blessing. Yes. I mean, Paul wants us to simply understand that whatever we yield our members to, we're the servants of whatever we yield our members to. If we yield our members to sin, then we are the servants of sin. God wants us to learn how to yield our members to righteousness, to the Spirit of the Lord, so that they become literally weapons. You know, King James translated the word instrument, but it literally is weapons. Weapons of righteousness to destroy and to tear down every demonic thing that goes on that prevents the move of God from being expressed in the church. From being expressed in your life. That prevents the rivers of divine, His divine life. You tell me, in Ezekiel chapter 47, anywhere that river flows, what happens? The land is healed. Anywhere that river flows, that which was a wilderness becomes a garden of Eden. Anywhere that river flows, the trees of life bearing 12 manner of fruit are growing. In other words, the fruitfulness of the things of the Spirit and the life and the nature of God. And it's not given to us by limit. It's given to us by an inexhaustible expression of divine glory. And at some place and at some time, you're going to have to get real with God, because the Spirit of truth is not going to hook up with pretend. And you just got to say, Lord, I want this kind of life. I want to live in this kind of relationship with You. I want to understand how evil it has been for me to speak against preachers or anyone.
Right.
Yeah.
How evil it has been for me to complain. How evil it has been for me to enter in any kind of strife. How evil it has been for me to be arrogant or prideful. How evil it has been for me to be self-reliant.
Right.
How evil it has been. For me to be involved in things that really has become almost like it's below the radar. Because relativism and culture, everybody's talking bad about somebody. And there's a lot of people who don't even have anything to talk about unless they're talking bad about somebody. They got to talk about what somebody did or somebody said or so, you know. Lord, forgive us. Forgive me for speaking. I'm never going to speak evil of anybody for the rest of my life. Because I've discovered how terrible it is to God.
Yes.
How much He despises it and hates it.
Yeah.
How big of a reproach it is to Him.
Yeah.
How I've compromised myself from being able to yield to the Spirit of the Lord.
Yeah.
How it steals from me and robs from me all these good things of life and joy. Because now I'm still a prisoner to that thing. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, tonight, every one of you, you're going to stand up in this place.
Yes.
And you're going to begin to walk differently.
Yes.
And we don't want you to work it out in here. We want you to drive down the road in your car and start screaming out to God till something right comes out. Why don't you start hollering out to God till something right starts coming out? Huh? We want you to go into your closet. Now, hopefully, you know, it's, you know, your neighbors aren't too close to you. We want you to work this thing out. Until the sounds of heaven and the sound of the joy start coming out. Lest we have to just go through an entire crazy mess in the midst of the church. Because I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to require of you by the Spirit of the Lord to bring an offering that's beautiful.
Amen.
An offering of praise that is glorious. I'm going to demand of you to bring that which only the Holy Ghost can do through you. That is excellent. That's excellent. People want to live in a life less than giving themselves to excellence. You'll never move in faith. Because faith is a whole other dimension of excellence. Just be sloppy with your stuff. Got to have a shovel to get into your car. So you can clean it out and be able to have a place to sit down. You look in your closet and you think it's like your laundry hamper that hasn't been tended to for 2 years. You know, somebody said, oh, he's gone from preaching to meddling. No, I'm just talking about your life and the evidence of who you are and what you're doing, whether or not you're a disciple and a disciplined one, whether or not you've given yourself over to the excellence, the things that the Spirit of the Lord God brings to us. People want to live the life of Joseph, but they don't want to give themselves to excellence. Come on. Stop the nonsense. Let's just get real. Just get real with God. Just say, Lord, I want to get this thing right. People want to get out of poverty, but they give themselves to a poverty mindset and a poverty lifestyle and poverty behavior. Come on. If your car's got 2 inches of rust on it, then let that 2 inches of rust be well shined and polished and well tended to. Let that be the most well-kept rusty car that there is. And what's right for the Lord to give you? It might be a 1966 Ford International. But you take good care of it, and you praise God for it. And you watch what the Lord will do. Same way with everything. Same way with everything. If you're sleeping on the floor, you just get excited about it. And man, you make sure that bed looks good. Huh? The way you put it all together. You get excited, man. You thank the Lord that you've even got a floor to sit on, because you could be on the dirt. We could go back to being thankful on the dirt, but I can advance you right to the floor and go take you back that far. Because on the dirt, you get to be happy about the fact that you're even alive to be able to lay there. You see, I'm not going to take you back that far. I'm going to go all the way to the floor. And you just begin to thank God you've got that floor and you've got that roof and he's so good. And you watch what happened. You're going to get yourself a cot real soon. Yeah. Hallelujah. The cot's coming. The cot's coming. I tell you, the cot's coming. The cot's coming. The cot's coming. The cot's coming. And you're just going to become excessively joyful and blessed. And my goodness, I got a cot now. Praise God. Wow, this is so much more comfortable than I've ever been before. And it isn't going to be long. I'm telling you right now, the bed that Father's going to roll out for you, my. And so it is in every dimension of our life. I mean, when we begin to be so thankful for what he's done, because, you know, at the end of the day, when, you know, we look at all that God's called us to do, and everything that God has called us to do is supernatural. Everything that he's called us to do is absolutely supernatural. There's just no way that you can naturally do it. I mean, it's just on the scale of only God can do it. That's what he's called us to do. So at the end of the day, when it's all said and done, and we look, we can maybe have attempted to evaluate our success and our failures, no, or become frustrated or overwhelmed by the fact that it seems like we should be there, we should have broken through to that realm yet, but we haven't. You know what? Every time, there is nothing bigger and nothing more important than the relationship that you have with him and that your place in him. In his place in you. And that's where we just get captivated. We get raptured. When I'm saying, Lord, why isn't it, Lord, that I haven't gone downtown San Diego and to the downtown morgue and pulled all those drawers in the downtown morgue and raised every one of those guys from the dead yet? And what is it, good? Father, what hinders, what limits me? Why, Father, can I break through into their realms of faith? And I'm just all kind of like on edge about it. I just repose and say, but I've got you, Father. You just so good. And you work this miracle of salvation for me, and you give it to me, this abundant, extraordinary life. And you're going to see me come to me. You're never going to see me come to the meeting like many of you, where it takes half this song service to get a smile out of you. And then if we say praise, you look like you're exhausted and don't know what to do. You're at the end of yourself. You're like, oh, God, I don't know what to do. Oh, God, just help me somehow. Don't do that. Don't get that far behind. That means you're way behind in your praise. That means you're way behind in your thanksgiving. I want everybody to stand with me so you can just change your position. I know some of you are excessively tired, and I want to get you refreshed. Amen. Father loves you. I know some of you are running hard, and especially those of you who took care of the children's ministry today. And I just want to say thank you. I mean, last week, I haven't heard the statistics on this week, but last week, and just I think the age groups of 7 to 12, there was over 20 people there. Sandy brought 8 of them. And I just want to see, I want to see more of God's people put their hand to work, because it's joyful, isn't it? You get threatened, but it's joyful, isn't it? You know what? It stretches you, right? It stretches you. Did you guys still renting the van, or did you buy the van?
Yeah, we're still renting.
You're still renting the van?
Yes.
Bless your heart. There's a flow of heaven there. There's a flow of heaven there. And you know, Sandy's like a stay-at-home mom. She doesn't really do anything. You know, she's got all this time in her hands. She's not really doing anything anyways. Of course, she's got a little bit of laundry to do and dishes to do and casual, everyday, normal things that you have to do when you have two girls in the house. Not. Not. She's working a full-time job. She's busy with her children. She's got everything else to do. Come on, people. Look, you want to begin to sort out the value system of your life. Let God do it tonight. It's not manipulation. It's not condemnation. It's evaluation. It's just examine yourself. What's going on? Because I want the church. You have to understand, I have a goal for the church. I want the church to be like what God described the church to be in the New Testament. I'm dedicated to doing my job. I'm dedicated to getting on my knees this week and crying out to God for the church and crying out for you and saying, Father, what hinders? Father, unveil, reveal your strategy for the church. What does it take to break people out of the things that they're stuck in that's keeping them from being able to move in praise and prophecy and joy and rejoicing and excitement in you? And that if somebody stops singing from the platform, everything goes silent because there's nothing there. It shouldn't be that way. What's going on in the platform, and be very careful with what you do. Be very careful with what you do. Because what happens is we just want to, you know, be just mildly, you know, influenced and affected by the Holy Ghost and then just do something out of that realm. No. No. You want to be baptized in the Spirit of the living God, and then do what you do out of the baptismal realm. And I promise you, there won't be silence when the person on the platform quits singing. When a person on the platform quits singing, it's not somebody told you guys that it was now a cue for you to, oh, everybody be quiet. I don't know who told you that, but let me just set the record straight. That's wrong. Because that praise and that worship was a springboard for you now.
Amen.
To start doing some serious spiritual aerobatics. Okay. Go ahead, giggle. That's close to joy. Don't hold it back. Don't hold it back. Everything that happens, you could be happy about it or sad about it. It's a choice.
True.
Everything that's said to you, you can be happy about it. You can laugh about it. I know a guy, his dear friend, God used him in such a wonderful way. And somebody was on the phone saying, you're not an apostle. So, you know, a person that's really, you know, He's got some clout in the ministry. You're not an apostle. You're not a pastor. You're not a teacher. You're not an evangelist. You're nothing. And my friend just started laughing. And the guy on the preacher on the other phone says, what are you laughing about? He said, you know, I've been always asking God what I was, and now I know. I'm nothing. You know, you have a choice. You have a choice. You have a choice. You can get upset about stuff, or you can get happy about it. I mean, the worst kind of thing. You can get upset about persecution, or you can rejoice.
Rejoice. I'm rejoicing.
Who wonder who said that? I wonder who said you're supposed to rejoice. I wonder where those... That actually sounded like, I think that's in the Bible. Matter of fact. How about those of you not even doing nothing to get persecuted for? I mean, your joy should be wide open. I mean, you got nothing challenging your joy. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You're only going to get persecuted for righteousness' sake. Righteousness' sake, in that context, is that you're reproving the lost world for sin and ungodliness. You're standing as a light unto the world. I'm going to preach the gospel. You're going to preach the gospel. You know what's going to come out of my mouth? Jesus.
Yes.
It's going to come out of my, you know what I'm going to find myself doing? Evaluating everything that I'm allowing in my life and saying, is this the spirit of the world or is it the spirit of the Lord?
Amen.
Come on, people. Yes. It's come. We just got to get real with God because he's the spirit of real. He's a spirit of real. He's a spirit of real. He's a spirit of real. He's the spirit of truth. I feel the same exact way. I just think this. I think this. I was dead in my trespasses and sins, without God, without Christ, lost in this world. And God commended his love to me while I was yet dead in my trespasses and sin. And he didn't just forgive me. He didn't just forgive me and make me a good human being. He caused me to be recreated in him so that I could be family with him. So that I could be intimate. So that I could be in the inner circle. Look. Joshua, you have the opportunity to be in the inner circle, but you can opt out. You can opt out because you're not getting in the boat and going across the sea. But they're crazy, man. I know more about fishing than that. Those guys, I thought they knew better. Storm's coming up. They were depending upon the arm of flesh, faithfully obeying, forgetting the fact that they had been taught that they could have authority over the wind and the waves, but nonetheless. They're getting ready to go to another dimension in God. I'm not going to opt out of the inner circle. The obedience to God is going to get you in the inner circle where Jesus didn't come and reveal himself walking on the water to anybody except for those in the inner circle, those who are going to willing to go all the way with him. There he showed himself. There he showed his glory. He took them just a few. Says, listen, you come just a few. Just a few. James, John, Peter. I mean, he loved Andrew. Andrew is one of the first disciples. Andrew didn't get to make the cut. Going to go up with me, going to see heaven's glory. I'm not going to, listen, I want to just provoke you tonight, and I want to provoke you in such a way that you will not forget. And I'm going to tell you something right now. The only way you can forget what I'm saying right now is because you did not give yourself to a place of prayer, a place of communion with the Holy Ghost. Because as soon as you do, he will cause you to remember everything that he said. Right. As soon as you touch heaven. If you don't touch heaven, it's just religious prayer. It's not going to be the case. But I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the things of the Spirit. The greatest adversary are people who are trained wrong and it's connected to Jesus. They trained wrong in prayer, and they qualify that as right. God shows us praying in the Spirit, praying in the Holy Ghost. He shows us what it looks like, and you should be going after it. Transfigured before them as he's praying. That's what it looks like. Transfigured. It going from one state to another state. It's a transcendent state of heaven so touching his earthly being that even his clothes shine with the brightness of eternity. Showing us this is a high watermark of prayer. And I'm not going to settle for some kind of religious ditty that I learned in Catholic school or among the religious folks of the grumpy sanctified. And then the religious groups. I want God, the Holy Spirit, to define for me. And with an honest and sincere heart to say, oh God, I so desperate. I see you over there in the realms of the heavenly. And I want that realm of the heavenly. I want rivers to flow out of me. I promise you. What the Lord was doing in my life last night, I said, sit in my chair. I'd been spending time in prayer.
And another dimension of prayer, I sat in my chair, vibrating with the peace of God, just peace. Tongue hanging out of your mouth, peace. Just to where you feel like, I could stay right here forever and never do nothing and never move. And there was, and it was totally quiet, and there was no expressions. I was so captivated by peace, I couldn't say nothing. The Lord takes us places there. He takes us there in that peace to explosive expressions of authority and power, to rivers of divine expressions of prophecy. And I pray in Jesus' name, I want you to, I pray, I'm asking God, I'm pleading with God in His mercy to do whatever it takes. And I'm beseeching you to yield to Him, to stop with whatever it is you're doing, because it's not getting you anywhere fast. I'm demanding of you change. And that's what the Lord says. He waits for the precious fruit of the earth to come forth as He's designed. Not just any kind of fruit, it's a precious fruit of the earth. He says to us, He addresses us, He says, "Dearly beloved, have patience unto the coming of the Lord Jesus." James says this in James chapter 5. For the husband waited for the precious fruit of the earth. He's waiting for something to be developed in us. And we've got to say, I've got to have that. And it's all it takes. Just takes a daily, I've got to have that. I want that. Father, use me. It just takes a willingness to lay down your life, to quit pursuing what you think is good. And I'm going to tell you something right now. Don't you say God said it if it can't be confirmed by the Word. And say God said it. Don't you say God's in it unless it's the activity of the Holy Ghost bringing forth signs and wonders and miracles. Don't you dare. It's evil. Don't you do that. You be careful where you throw His name around at, what you tag His name onto. Go marketing with Jesus, making merchandise of the Lord. That's what Satan did when he fell. That's how he caused men to fail. He made merchandise to the Lord. Don't you do that. Just come humbly before Him. Walk with Him. Just find yourself accepted and beloved. Just be excessively happy. And when something starts distracting you, just come back to the fact that I am redeemed. Look. Let's look at an example. Job has everything taken from him. Everything's been destroyed. He's sitting in sackcloth and ashes, scraping boils off of himself, being persecuted by everybody that he thought was his friend. And look at what he says. I know my Redeemer lives. I mean, come on. No one should take my uprightness from me. I know my Redeemer lives. And should stand upon the earth and last day, though my body be turned into dust, yet shall it live again. Wow, you talk about making something good out of a bad situation. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
That's right. That's right. You shout to the Lord. You rejoice in the Lord, your God. Amen. You lift up your voice and you praise Him. You give thanks unto the Lord in all things. This is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus, that in all things you give thanks, that you rejoice evermore. that you come to understand. And though I really didn't get into it in detail tonight because the Lord just wouldn't allow me to focus there, Father set a high water mark of what it looks like to come before Him. And it was an excessive joy and rejoicing and celebration. And then when you look in heaven and you see what the seraphims are doing and you see what the Zoa are doing, they got it going on. They know how to make it happen. You see what the 24 elders are doing? You see what the innumerable company of saints are doing? I'm telling you right now, there ain't nobody groaning and moaning. Ain't nobody thrashing themselves. There's nobody trying to repent and get right. I mean, come on, it's a celebration. And tomorrow night, you may not be in the church meeting, but you should be in the meeting. Should be in the meeting. We're getting ready to put up the tent in Oregon. I mean, I just got it so big in on the inside of me. We're getting ready to put the tent up so we can just start having the meeting. It doesn't matter how many people are there. We just want to touch heaven. Daniel, you and Summer, just touch heaven. You go over in the Holy Ghost realm, and it's an offering that's beautiful. We got to quit bringing these complaint offerings, and it sounds rough and terrible and like somebody's trying to wrestle a kangaroo to the ground. And I tell you, that is a crazy sight. He said he said they're beautiful. And he'd be something excellent. And he'd be something glorious. You let the floodgates of heaven open wide in your life. And watch as the power of God comes pouring out. You open up the floodgates of your life. There's places in California tonight that they shut off the floodgates. Well, now it's going to be kind of remedied after this year, but up into this year, they'd shut off the floodgates, and the place that was a fruitful garden, it just turned into a desert. There's ranchers where we ranch out in Oregon, and they shut off the floodgates so that water couldn't get to the pasture, so there was no hay because of water. Limitation. It's a terrible, tragic thing when you close off the floodgate. That's what I'm always doing with God's people. Oh my. Floodgate's been shut off. And that's what I'm getting at. Now you're feeling me right now. You're feeling me right here. Oh my. Somebody grab the valve. Hakuma is setelemote. I promise you, you listen to me. You simply do the things that God's asked you to do, and heaven will be revealed to you. This is what the Lord says. Heaven will be opened unto you, the supply of heaven, the riches of heaven, the blessings of heaven, the glory of heaven will be realized by you. There's things that you've allowed in your life that you're just going to simply say no to. But you know what? If you're not allowing those things which Father has given to be realized, it's hard to say no to that other aggravating stuff. Just baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. When you're born again and a wellspring is springing of the very life of God. So happy, you can't be happier. Listen. It is impossible to make God happier right now. It is impossible for you or anything or anyone in any place, anywhere in the universe to make God any happier than He is. That's how happy He is. That's the joy He has for us. That you can step into happy that nothing can make you happier. And let me tell you, nothing can make Him sad either. Nothing can take any of His joy. Nothing can take any of His joy. And Father, I want you to come into a place of relationship with Him that nothing can steal your joy. Nothing can take your peace. Nothing can steal your peace. Nothing can take your love. And He invites us into this fellowship. And it's, wow. And some people think, oh, it's fictional. No, it's not. It's real.
It's a miracle. The one thing that you do not want to do is leave this place and not being right with God. And I'm going to tell you, you cannot be right with God unless every part of your life is submitted to Him. You cannot be right with God unless your life is upon the altar of God and you're not doing your own thing, walking in your own way, because the Lord has said over and again, depart from me, work of iniquity. You never did the will of the Father. You never did my will. See, the world and the lust thereof will pass away, but they that do the will of the Lord will endure forever, will last forever, will go on forever. Tonight, you just let the Spirit of the Lord show you if there's things going on in your life, things that you're allowing in your life that is not right, it's not appropriate, stop it now. If there's a question, stop it now. Get right with the Lord tonight. And it's so simple to get right with Him. Say, Lord, I surrender to You. That's all you have to do. Lord, I yield myself to You. Lord, all I want is what goes on in heaven. I don't want what's going on in hell. Lord, I choose You. I don't want anything to do with the demonic. I don't want anything to do with the powers of darkness. I don't want anything to do with the world and its system. In the name of Jesus, I set you free. If there's anybody standing in here tonight, you have never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus. He's made it so easy. It's like He said to the man who was born blind, do you believe on the Son of Man? The man that was born blind, all he had simply said is, who is He, sir, that I may believe on Him? The Lord makes it that simple. Father wants to come and work a miracle in your life. If you're bound up with something, if you're oppressed with something, if you've got some unholy thing going on in your life, unholy thoughts that are plaguing you, unholy things that you're yielding yourself to, Christ Jesus wants, He loves you. He wants to deliver you from them. He doesn't reject you. He wants to deliver you from them. I'm going to ask everybody in this place right now, if you would, just please lift your hands towards heaven and let the Spirit of the Lord have His way with you. Let Him go into every room of your life. Let Him go into every department of your life, your attitudes, your passions, your emotions. Let Him touch you. Let Him change you. Let Him strengthen you. Let Him heal you. Let Him help you. Let Him become God to you. Let Him become your God. And He is the only God. And I'm telling you right now, when you have the sovereign God in your life and nobody can touch you, hurt you, no evil thing can befall you. You know what I do? I'm going to tell you, I've watched this over and again. The Lord loves His people so much. Somebody starts doing something, messing with me in any way, it doesn't bother me. Really, it doesn't. But I'll earnestly start praying, interceding for them, saying, Lord, don't hold it to their charge. Because He's so jealous over us. He's so jealous. He's so protective of us. Wow. Isn't that amazing, Sonny? He so loves us. He's so protective. God loves you so much. God loves you more than you could ever know. And there's nothing that you have to praise and rejoice over. Begin to let the Spirit of wisdom and revelation show you that. Hallelujah. Tonight, for every person in this place, you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I promise you, every one of your sins are released from you. Those of you who call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ because you don't want that stuff in your life anymore, it's broken. Jesus' name, it's released from off of your life. It's no longer retained in your life. It's no longer retained. No longer has power over you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Precious blood of Jesus that washed me white as snow, that cleansed me from every stain of sin, that loosed me, that let me go. Free from my prison. Freed from every lie. To live in this realm of glory. To live in this fellowship with Him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I want you to get an offering ready and get your tithe. The tithe is the 10% of everything that comes into your life. And the Lord asked for it because He says it's His. You can argue with Him about it if you want, but I'm not going to argue with Him about anything. He knows what He's talking about. And He says it's His, and He says what He's going to do is He's going to bless you by using that as a means by which He's going to multiply to you. Just like the few loaves and the few fishes, somebody had to give a little bit. And He multiplied it, and it was provision beyond anything. It was not enough for one person to get full. Come on. Right? Two small fish, pickled fish. Right? And four barley loaves. Poor people's food. The Lord take your tithes and your offerings and you'll bless it. And you'll multiply it to you. You start doing it right. You're getting it right. Hallelujah. And Papa's just going to, you know, make a giver out of you. You'll just be giving right, left, and center. You know, I received a report from Naveen today, and he said, you know, because of your giving, what they were doing with the untouchables, now they've regained full momentum with what they were doing. Because they had, basically, they had built the church and the ministry there where they were being supported locally in India. And then because of the economy in India, a big portion of that support just vanished. And then we were able to come in there and start blessing them. So, you know, everything that they do at the Untouchables is effective because Hindus don't want the Untouchables. So you can go, you know, in places in India, you can't preach to Hindus, minister to Hindus, without getting in serious trouble. Even threatening your life. But the Untouchables, no problem. You could go do whatever you want to do with them. Because not even the government wants to do anything with them. And there's hundreds of thousands. Well, there's millions. I mean, I can't remember what percent of the population. I mean, there's a huge population, like 1.2 billion people. And, you know, it's a huge part of the population. Yeah, so, you know, yeah, it could be as high as 200 million. So it's ready to be gotten. And so, you know, we're being able to now support them with about $1,000 a month, and, you know, what they're doing with the orphanages there, and also what we're doing with the orphanages in Nepal, and we're able to take care of things here. And, you know, because Father's got us doing a lot of different things. We're not only about the local church, but we're also about planting churches. And we're not only about planting churches, but we're also about evangelizing the churches here in America and evangelizing churches throughout the world. I mean, we'll be all over the world this year again. We'll be all over the place. And it's also about doing mass evangelism crusades. And so, I mean, we're, you know, and a lot of people, they don't like it. Pastor's gone. He's not hardly a year. And you need to start flowing in the Holy Ghost. You need to start putting a demand upon yourself to where the Spirit of the Lord begins to speak through you.
Yes.
Amen. And if you want to understand how to do that, just come talk to Sandy. Because you're going to have to set your hand on the plow and start reaching the lost. And it really just go get the lost. Because when you do, you open up the floodgate to yourself. Because all the things, the concerns, the power ministry is about reaching the lost. You don't reach the lost. The only way you define, it's defined about doing the gospel of the kingdom is reaching them, teaching them, and sending them. So what you do has to, and when Sandy was talking to me about this and what she's going to do in Escondido, I said, that's fine, I'm all for it. But you have to have an entry point into the church. Because otherwise, it's just not even right. It's just not even effective. It's not what Jesus said to do, so you're not doing what... Let's go ahead and hook up with what he says to do. And so I want you... You know, you get to send your money to Naveen and the church there in India to go do work that many people in here you wouldn't want to do because the untouchables are untouchable because they're the caste system of very poor people and it's pretty tough living situations. You and I wouldn't be used to that. We're not used to that, eating that kind of food, cooking on a weird, crazy 100-year-old pan on an open fire. I mean, goes, you know, it's... Hey? Bugs crawling all over the place and they want to bless you, you know. And you're happy. That, but right now, the Lord's got an opportunity for you and you're going to have to find it. You're going to have to quit hesitating. Quit hesitating. Quit hesitating. Build the local church. Be a part of building the local church. If you'll be part of building the local church, you'll function in the flow of the local church. You've got to build it. You need to build it. So it's in that context that you want offering. You want to bring an offering. You're believing God. Father, I want to be used by you more effectively. I want to do the work of the kingdom.
Yes.
I want to have a compassion and a love for the lost. I want to have a love for people. I want to learn how to love people in the first 4 seconds. If you commit to that, you'll find out how much stuff has been working on you that you didn't even notice. Huh? Too many of God's people are like Professor Gadget. You know, the radar comes out, the satellites beaming, and they're discerning all the things that's wrong with people. Give me a break. It don't take much discernment. God's called us to love people. To fall in love with them. You can say, well, I'm busy with this and I'm busy with that. Well, that's just exactly what they were telling Jesus when he said, follow me. Yeah. Well, I'm busy with my children. Well, I'm busy with my field. Well, I'm busy with, you know, some oxen. Well, I'm busy with... You hear his response to it. Are you going to do your kingdom or his kingdom? I'm amazed about how people get excited about their kingdom. Don't do that. Don't do that. And if it rises up, you throw it down. Because I promise you, it will turn into death in your hands. I promise you. It will. God in his mercy will allow it to be the plague that it is. Set your heart on the things of heaven. Watch what God will do.
Thank you, Jesus.
Why prevent the blessing? Amen? Then prevent the blessing. If there's anybody sick or diseased or hurting and in pain, anybody walking around doing their own thing, saying it's God, we want to pray for you.
Amen.
Anybody here tonight in condemnation, shame, and guilt?
No.
We want to release you. I want you to be released. Anybody unhappy with their husband or wife?
No.
We want you to get delivered. Anybody in this place listening to me by the web have addictions, tormenting things on your life? I'll release you from it now in Jesus' name. It goes out of your life. Out in Jesus' name. I did that just to do that right there in a third world country. Everybody's completely laid out. In the United States of America, we're so used to things that we just can almost resist it. We don't even know. But there's authority in that. Power. I can feel it. Can you feel it?
Yes.
Wow. If I was bound up, I'd have got liberated just then. Isn't it wonderful to be walking around in love and feeling good all the time?
Yes.
Don't be without it. Do you know that there's a secret to where you're at right now, this love that you feel, this glory that you feel? You know what it is? You're thinking about the things of the Spirit. You've given yourself to just meditate on the Word of God for a couple of hours here. In the congregation of the people of God. You can do that alone, too. It's always great to have two or three people. Listen, if you've really not known how to enter into prayer and to, you just haven't understood that, touch your hand with prayer, get together with a person like your wife or your husband and do it. And watch, the Lord, the Holy Ghost is there to teach you. He'll show you how.
Yes.
Phew. And then take that wonderful outpouring of the Spirit of the living God and go love on people. Go compel them to come into His house so that His house may be full.
Amen.
His house isn't full tonight. Somebody said, well, I brought somebody, but they didn't stay. Fine, go get 10 more. Go get 10 more. You got to keep bringing people in. Sometime, I need to minister to you on the 10 lepers. 10 are healed, but one comes out. That's the statistic. Especially among people in America. You see 10 people get a miracle, 10 people touched by God, one returns. One for 10. Those are good statistics. Martha, the Lord is about to shock you. He's about to shock you. Shockingly good things. Because you delight yourself in Him, and He also gives you the desires of your heart. According to some people's theology, that would be something evil. No. The desires of our heart are good and pure and holy.
Amen.
Right. Amen. Father, I thank you for this increase of the Spirit. Increase the manifestation of your power and of your glory. With prophecy and with exhortation. Sandy probably picked the most, if not the most, one of the most violent places in San Diego to have a ministry. Where if you're a gringo, you do not feel safe. And just intense gang violence. You know, the Lord's got a place for you in this city. There's over 3 million people, and the majority of them have never been reached. They've never been loved on. I believe it takes a whole lot less to reach 3 to 10-year-olds than it does anyone else. You can reach a 3 to 10-year-old with an ice cream cone. The older they get, the more complicated it becomes. That's the Spirit of the Lord birthed within you a heavenly vision. Vision of the kingdom. Hey, sweetie, what's your name? Huh?
Natalia.
It's nice to meet you, Natalia.
Me too.
Did you come with this family right here? You came with who? Oh, okay. Well, we're glad to have you here. Father, thank you for your blessing, Natalia. Bless her in Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, nothing in this world will ever be able to claim you. I put the blood of Jesus Christ and the life of the kingdom of God upon you. Now in Jesus' name, you belong to heaven. Amen. Let everybody stand with me. Bring your best. That'll be beautiful.
You say, Lord, how do I get something beautiful for you? And he says, I've supplied the Holy Ghost to fulfill that task.
Amen.
And I begin to reach to him. I say, Holy Ghost, only you can do this through me. Only you can bring something beautiful. Only you can bring something through me worthy of the King. Histabaranea. Hande, ronde, ishte. Hambrode. Hambroda. Hambredea. Helistea. Helimeneste. Helimenea. Himevist. Maleda kuna meteli ipe. Malaya ne montipa itu husht. Isretest. Isretest. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. How you doing? Bless you. What's your name?
Bill.
Bill? Welcome. What's your name? Pam? Bless you. Father, thank you for your life-giving flow that you provided to us through the Holy Ghost. Father, we pray right now in the name of Jesus. I pray right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, that Bill and Pam step into the realms of divine glory like they've never known. Oh God, that everything that you've ever declared and everything that you've ever revealed and everything that they've ever asked for and prayed for and everything that they've ever wanted in you will begin to be realized as they lay hold on that which you provided for them. In Christ Jesus. So you place it above all other things. In Jesus' name. 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 Bless you. Mambrere stididu la mambrere te kasutas to nanamaka deep numba deep. Happy land. Happy land. Thank you, Jesus. You know, some people think that the Lord's upset with them. And he was walking around heaven bragging on them. And then how the enemy messes all everything up. Enemy is thinking liar, man. Huh? Come on. Come on. Yeah. Come on, man. Come on. Come on, man. Come on. Esse la Eli. Asutu of Italietest. From the crown of your head to the sole of your feet, I tell you right now, your heart's so full. Your heart's so full. Your heart's so full. So full of that which Father has ordained, so full of that which Father has purposed. You should begin to explode from your life with divine expressions of the Spirit, divine expressions of power, and divine expressions of authority. Mashista. 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 Huraha, 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 huraha. Huda, oh, rejoice and be glad. Huda ha. Ha ha ha. Huda ha. Huda ha. Huda ha. Do not try to think of something. Do not try to invent it within the realms of your imagination, but simply say, yes, Lord, I will do it and I will go. And Father will give you revelation. Revelation is very different from imagination. Revelation is an insight that God brings to us by the Holy Ghost. Imagination is something that we invent within the framework of the human experience. God, by revelation, will show you what to do.
He will inspire you with a divine ability and resource you to do it. So don't be stuck thinking in your mind, saying, how am I going to make this happen? How am I going to do this? Lord, you know I want to do more for you. And then you try to organize all the various different logistics. Do not do it. Father will give you step-by-step revelation. Now in the name of Jesus Christ, this is what takes place in your life. It changes in you. You're not going to be paralyzed by analysis. You're not going to get into the headache of imagination, trying to figure it out. I don't know, what can I do? Say, God, I'm willing to go. Lord, I want to be used by you. Here's my hands, here's my feet. Direct me. Show me how. Man, explode on the inside of you. Just explode on the inside of you. And see, you're not going to do anything for God effectively unless you begin to move in the realms of faith. And that's how faith comes. Faith comes by the spoken word of God to you. The Lord just causes faith to stand up on the inside of you. You know you can do it. And it doesn't take money. Honestly, it doesn't take money. I mean, we've done massive answers in crusades. We would say it costs way more money than anybody could imagine. God just did it. He just supernaturally did it. Come on now. It doesn't take money. This takes the realm of faith. It's the realm of supernatural faith. There it is. Go ahead, take it. Just go ahead, take it. Empowered, David Graham. Empowered to live your life gloriously.
Yes, Lord.
Honorably. To bring glory and honor to the King of Kings.
Yes, Lord.
Yes. He gives you the ability.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, he does. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
And just let the Lord clothe you with the mind of Christ. And you just let him clothe you with the realms of thinking after the Spirit, the spiritual mind.
Yes, Lord.
The mind of the Spirit.
Thank you, Jesus.
What a glorious way to live.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord. James Levesque will be with us next Sunday. And then he's actually going to stay till Wednesday. By now we're just planning on doing, you know, he'll tag team with me on Sunday. He's going to be doing a meeting on Wednesday night. And that's all we're planning on doing right now. We're not planning on stretching out meetings right now. Then Sal Sabino will be with us on that Saturday and Sunday night. So we're going to do a Saturday night, Sunday night with Sal Sabino.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Your presence is so.
That is beautiful, sir.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Sometimes I can't say it loud enough and deep enough. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
So from a thank you, Jesus. Daniel and Summer are going to go to Zambia with us this year.
Hallelujah. Mom's real excited about that.
I am too. Oh, Rabo Shekili Bioto. No, the Lord is doing great things right now in the church in America. It's in small pockets right now. But it's people going, we are tired of singing the songs. We're tired of just doing it the way we've been doing it. We've got to have a divine encounter with the living God. It's got to be like Pentecost. And because and there's, this is even happening in larger places where there are well over 1,000 people in the meeting, which is very unique because usually these kinds of things can only happen in smaller churches. Because it's hard to get that many people on the same page. But it's beautiful what God's doing. And it's an exciting to be a part of it. And I pray that you just reach to God, that you'll be on the front end of it. You'll be in a place with God where you there personally are pressing it. You're pressing it. You're moving it forward. You're advancing it in your fellowship with Him. And you're walking your relationship with Him. Do it.
Yes.
Do it. You won't be disappointed. You reach out to have all that God has supplied. I'm promising you have it. Come here. What's up? Come here. Yeah. How are you doing? Come here. Stand over here. Stand by Ann. It's such a big blessing to have Kyla.
It is such a blessing.
Kyla and baby.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. We love you so much, Kyla. Your sister was here this morning. Thank you, Father, for great supernatural provision.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father, for the supply of the Spirit. For your signs and wonders and miracles.
Thank you, Father.
For the display of your glory in this life. The revelation of Jesus Christ and Kyla. Your servant Kyla. Well, come worship the Lord with you giving. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our God, our Maker. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Maker. For He is our God. Hallelujah. And we are the people of His pasture and the sheep of His hand. Were the sheep of His. Beautiful. There are such great anointings in this place right here upon the servants of the living God in this place. And I want you to be more confident and more bold and more certain about what God is going to do through you than you've ever been. Yes. Because I'm telling you, faith must have and be accompanied with boldness and confidence for it to work. So those things that have tried to beat you down and tried to defeat you and tried to hold you back and tried to be to you, as it were, a great wall of hindrance, let them exist no longer. Let them exist no longer. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. All worthy of your hand, worthy of your hand.